Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
Part 2. A scheme. 2 days later. Morticia shifted uncomfortably in her bed, holding onto the rails for support. Grant glanced over his clipboard, seeking the issue. "Are you all right, my lady?" he asked. "No. When can I get up and walk farther than here to the head?" she asked irritably. "Presumably, right now." "That said, I didn't say that," Grant cautioned. "HMPH. You ever been in one of these?" she asked, halting her fidgeting as she found a place to lie comfortably. "I have. An accident when I was a kid." "Yeah?" Morticia looked over at him. "What happened?" "Fell off a jungle gym, landed chin first on a block of corrugated aluminum," Grant said. "Now, that makes me cringe just thinking about it," Morticia said. "As does a lung replacement." "How are you feeling?" Grant asked, returning his eyes to his clipboard, carefully checking off the chemical components of her hive. "A lot better, actually." Morticia flexed her hands experimentally, felt nothing amiss. "Did Dad happen to say when he'd get back?" "He did not, my lady, but it is 0100. "You should really get some sleep," Grant said. "Sleep is for people who aren't gene-seeded," Morticia said. Grant raised his eyebrows. "Excuse me, madam?" Morticia stared. "You didn't know?" "No, know what, my lady?" Grant asked. He started to wonder whether it would be wise to call in one of the normal staff. "Oh. I guess I assumed Dad would have, never mind," Morticia said. "Well, you wondered why I kept coming out of sedation, right? It's because I'm genomoded. The guy they have operating my life support really ought to know that," she added with a smile. A cold chill descended over the young nurse. "Forgive me, my lady, I had no idea," Grant said, a twinge of desperation in his voice. "Relax, I was kidding." Morticia cocked her head at him. "Who are you, anyway?"
My name.
I'm Grant, my lady, and I'm your night care specialist for the foreseeable future," Grant said, pulling himself together. "Not by yourself."
"Well, yes, my lady."
"Isn't that unusual?" she asked. "Having a single staffer in an intensive care unit?" "The background check carried out on my colleagues was exhaustive, my lady," Grant started.
"Probably for the best," Morticia said, reading between the lines well enough. She watched Grant finish his checklist, gauging him through her clear, gray eyes.
"Sorry if I made you nervous."
"It's not your fault, my lady, that my superiors have not seen fit to alert me to your atypical medical requirements."
"How old are you?" Morticia asked.
"I'm 27 years old, madam," Grant said.
"Then please stop treating me like I'm made of glass, Grant," Morticia said.
"Madam, I don't think you're made of glass. However, if I treat you in any way that could be interpreted as inappropriate by those strapping young men outside, they may well treat me like I'm made of ballistics gel," Grant deadpanned.
Mortarion stood before the Emperor's desk. The Emperor had steepled his fingers over his desk and looked at his son with an air of patience.
"Mortarion, I think you should know I refused a request by Azakariman to perform a psychic auger on the would-be assassin."
Mortarion stood agape.
"What?"
"Morticia, she means the world to you, my son." The Emperor stood behind his desk and was dwarfed by his son, but did not turn his gaze away.
"I can fully appreciate how you feel, I assure you. But, the shooter. Keita. He worships Morticia. He thinks of her as a demigoddess." The Death Guard reeled.
That's treason. A violation of the creed.
Why is he not being prosecuted for it?"
"Because we don't have the evidence to prove it."
"Yet," the Emperor pointed out.
"I held this from you because you have had, I think, far too much on your mind of late. I did not want to burden you over much. But to be honest, with the declaration of intent for Seclus Arius on his trial, the assassin leaves us little room to work.
If he even seems to be eluding justice, I will carve his heart out," Mortarion said flatly. It wasn't a threat. I have no doubt. But I suspect that such an approach will go over poorly with the trillions of Morticia's well-wishers. Have you seen how she is being portrayed by the media? I make a point of avoiding such drivel," Mortarion scoffed. As well you should, Mortarion. My point is that your daughter, primary victim though she may have been of this catastrophe, she deserves better than a streak of vengeance. Of her attacker being violated, as she was. The Emperor's gaze skewered Mortarion's seething visage. She deserves to find her closure in the arms of justice. Listen to you. Mortarion said angrily. I watched as you forced Lorga to bend the knee. I watched as you purged loyal worlds for the sin of worship. Now you spare an ideologue murderer his punishment because of, what? Media pressure? Or is it location? Can you not bring yourself to harm Terra itself? Mortarion's blank grey eyes narrowed to slits. Or do Morticia's life and well-being not mean as much to you as I had hoped? The Emperor was silent for all of 1 second. In that second, his eyes flashed a burst of cerulean blue, like a robin's egg, piercing through his skin and through the lights of the office. In a moment, they vanished, and his temper was reined. Mortarion saw it all, and 2 weeks before, would have flinched away, in surprise or even anger. But now, he stood. His dead, empty eyes met his father's, and he stared straight back. Morticia means more to me than you know, my son. For that reason, I will forgive you your insinuations, and your lapse of memory, the Emperor said. Lapse of memory? Mortarion hissed. I remember the horror as my wife was taken from me by a disease I gave her. I will not let my daughter be taken from me by a madman with poor aim. No, my son, you will not. She lives. She will be strong again. But that to which I refer is not the loss of your wife, nor my actions in the crusade. The thing to which I refer is the identity of the other injured party to that attempted murder, the Emperor said coldly. And, lest we let the knowledge fade from our minds, her father's methods are somewhat more subtle than yours. Kelly Kurz ran her hands together, trying to calm her nerves. Her new therapist was supposed to arrive soon, and she didn't know what to expect. She had been persuaded to wash her makeup off, but it sure didn't make her feel better. Her father stood near, trying to sort his own thoughts. Her problem was alien to him. He had slain his way across entire arms of the galaxy, left grown men shivering in fear of his name, and frightened entire star systems into solving their own rebellions before he arrived to handle it in person. On Selgura, he had been the sole survivor of an entire joint army Astartes battalion, sent in to cleanse a particularly recalcitrant horde of Dark Elder. He had witnessed blessedly false visions of his own father killing him. He had watched his homeworld slip dangerously close to falling back into the ways of corruption and evil that he had so laboriously purged in his childhood. He thought, he had to think, that if he had been the one who had watched Morticia being shot, he would have been far more capable of overcoming it. But he reminded himself, was not his daughter. And she didn't have his millennia of killing to harden her soul. Perhaps that was for the best. Kelly, you know that as soon as the session's over, I'll be here to pick you up, right? You don't have to stay in the hospital, he offered. Dad, please, I'm scared. I don't want to go home yet, Kelly said, her voice thin. Even without her eyeshadow, there were dark circles under her eyes. Kurz clamped his teeth around his tongue. He didn't think his daughter was weak. He didn't. But all he could see was someone who had reacted poorly to something he saw every single day, or near enough, for several thousand years. His wife gave him a reproachful glare, then leaned forward, squeezing their daughter's shoulder. Kelly, if you want me to be here for this. No, thanks, Mom, Kelly said, clenching her hands tighter. Her shoulders hunched a bit to her mother's touch, but she looked up and made eye contact. Thanks, though. Kelly, Conrad struggled to find words. I want to understand. I know you do, Dad, but I don't really understand either, Kelly said sadly. That's why I'm here. Okay, okay. The doctor's footsteps sounded from down the hall. Conrad made his mind up. Kelly, I'll be back to hear how it went, okay? I hope you feel better. Me too, Kelly said. She made a little wave of farewell as her parents walked out, her mother pausing to speak to the doctor. Conrad walked down the hallway, making for the elevator to the Erica lot, planning his route. As he ascended to the lot, his mind churned, thinking over the precious little information he had gleaned thus far. He was sure the Emperor would not approve of his taking matters into his own hands, but it wasn't like it was unprecedented. The door pinged open, and he stepped out into the cordon of waiting Night Lord serfs. My Lord Curse? A gravelly voice asked from the shadows of the lot. The serfs each took a long step back from the Primarch, leveling their las rifles at the speaker. As a Karaman stepped forth from the darkness, his eyes locked onto Curse. May I speak to you a moment? Curse looked at the old warrior askance. You're Araman, right? Magnus man? I am, Lord. I have a piece of valuable knowledge to pass along to you. One of the Night Lords looked over his shoulder subtly. Give us the room, men, Curse said at length. The Night Lord serfs snapped to attention, then marched off in the direction of their staff car. He waited until he was out of earshot before speaking back up. What is it? My lord, I suspect that Cerulus's Keita had some assistance in his deed, Araman said frankly. I suspect also that the Arbites, for all their zeal, are overplaying their hand and disregarding some potentially valuable sources of information. Araman tapped his staff on the ground for emphasis. Such as? Curse asked. Such as those who resent them. Any figure of law enforcement is going to be resented on a world where crime runs so rampant as terror. They will have questioned the obvious suspects, like the Civil Honors Union, his relatives, what have you. But sources of information in a criminal investigation are rarely cooperative with the Arbites, I have learned. Besides, we are both of the enlightened race. Are we not? What of it? Conrad growled. His psychic talents had certainly never helped him much. My point, Lord, is that we would be better served in our search amongst those who revile this Keita than amongst his friends. Look for information from those who would offer it up gladly, and look for a lie where it forms. Curse was silent. Two men in power armor would be as far from subtle as it is possible to be. But, as he had so frequently learned, fear was a weapon. And if Araman was right. The Emperor had spoken to him in private after the incident with Furia. He had been told to never employ such measures against civilians again. He had given his word. He had intended to keep them. And then he had watched his daughter shivering in terror in the hospital room, blood soaking her clothes. All it would take, he was sure, was one visit by the Night Haunter, and nobody in his path would fail to yield the information he sought. He closed his eyes for a moment, seeking the tendrils of fate, but they were clouded and out of his reach. He opened them again to see Araman staring at him through the visor of his helmet, inscrutable. Where did you get this lead? Curse asked. From a vision I received. It was abrupt, and full of things that do not seem to have come to pass, but enough did that I think this warrants investigation. We will be spotted. This will not be stealthy, Curse said. And yet, Araman let the statement hang in the air. Where? Curse asked of the Sicker. Araman opened his palms. The hive tops. One of the areas not supposed to have been reconditioned like Starsite, but instead one that sprung up from whole cloth. They are full of the world's most destitute, but also the world's most loyal. Double quote. Very well, Brother Araman. We go. And let us hope you are right, Curse growled. Unpleasant repercussions. The Emperor clenched his hand over his fist, resting them on his chin. His granddaughter Isis and her friend Julius, bruises and all, sat in chairs before his desk, with Araman and, true to form, his son Conrad, standing behind them. On his desk was a report from the coroner's officer, detailing the scene of grisly genocide Curse had found. Next to it was another report, from the Tetrahive Praetor's office, describing how several unidentified genomodit men had been found with various contusions and burns on their bodies, splayed out in a garbage bin nearby. Yet a third report, this one penned by a very confused arbitrator judge, bespoke the seeming contradictions that the Civil Honors Union suffered regarding their opinions of their sanctioned status and governmental funding. The Emperor slowly looked up at both teens. Julius, he noted, was swooning in nerves and fear, and Isis just looked sullen and exhausted. Ahriman, on the other hand, looked so embarrassed that it was honestly quite distracting, while Kurz was Kurz, and looked no more or less stable and rational than he ever did. Well. The Emperor stacked the three reports on his desk and swept them into an envelope. Seems I'm not the only one who's had an interesting evening. Let's start with you, Seer Pius. What on Terra possessed you to think that discharging a Helgen in public was wise? Knowledge of the alternative, my liege, the dark-haired young man said, his voice nearly cracking under the strain. Then, he was 17. Those Babu thugs were going to gut us. Better alive and penalized than, well, dead. Sir. The Emperor nodded slowly, wondering where the kid had even gotten his hands on that kind of hardware, and suspecting that the answer would involve pointed questions with either his father or one of the legions with which he had fought. Isis, why did you go into the hive? Because I think, I know, there's more to this than we've found out, Isis said urgently. Her tone bespoke disappointment and genuine concern. I cannot believe that a single junior maintenance technician could have possibly smuggled a sniper rifle into Startside without assistance. And thusly informed, and sure in the solidity of your intelligence, you then ventured in the absence of any sort of protection, into the depths of the poorest and most crime-ridden hab of the most impoverished block of the most dangerous cube in the entire hive grid, the Emperor finished. Isis squirmed. I know it was unwise, now. But we did find out some useful things. Yes, I'm sure. You'll have all the time in the world to relay them to your father when you see him next, the Emperor said, his voice laden with hidden meaning. Isis blanched. The Emperor lifted one hand slightly, as if it were the cup of a scale. Both of you disappoint me. Such recklessness. You thought to find some hint of a conspiracy, didn't you? We did, sire, Julia said. A bead of sweat gathering on his brow. And if you had found it? What then? Fighting? Flight? You were equipped for neither, the Emperor said. You were nearly killed by a group of criminals. Had we gone with backup, we would have found nothing, Isis said bluntly. Which, conveniently enough, is what you found anyway, the Emperor said. He lowered his hand, tapping the envelope. You see, now I have to deal with the fact that my own granddaughter was seen shooting someone in the hive, mere days after her own cousin was shot. Now, I have to deal with the fact that Terrans are wondering if perhaps there was more to this shooting than random terrorism, when previously there had not been, he said, his voice rising. The blood in Julius' face drained. You two have, in a stroke, complicated this investigation to the extent that it may not conclude peacefully. Now, we have a brooding gang war in a hive on my own doorstep, and the fact that one of my warriors is a criminal mastermind has been aired to any who were watching. There was neither mercy nor regrets in his demeanor as he leaned forward. Neither of you are ever to enter the hives again. Isis, should your father choose to levy some other constraints upon you, I will voice no objection. Seer Pius, I would think carefully if I were you, regarding the possibility of being seen in public for a few months. He didn't need warp mastery to interject the specter of something terrible into his voice. Both teens recoiled, but stayed silent. The Emperor glanced over both older men, but neither said a word, with Kurz practically radiating his disgust for the entire affair. The Emperor leaned back in his seat, reining in his temper. Now. Both of you, get home. I imagine I'm not the only person waiting to speak to either of you, he said coldly. Both stood, Julius looking like he was ready to vomit, Isis just looking sad. As soon as they were out of the room, the Emperor turned his anger on the two older men. Now. They're 17 years old, with no security clearance to speak of, and desperate for insight. What are your excuses? Ahriman spoke first. I apologize for not mentioning it sooner, but I sensed it would be unwise to make mention of this in front of the children. Mentioning what? The Emperor demanded. Our search was not so fruitless. We have found more to this than the Arbites detected, Kurz finished. One of the witnesses to Keita's deviancy bore the taint of Tsinch. Not enough to control him, he said, correctly anticipating his father's next question, but enough to confuse him, render him useless as a witness. I obtained that much from him. But as to whether chaos plays a role here or is merely seeking an advantage, I suspect the latter, Ahriman confessed. The Emperor sighed, staring through the tangled mass of futures and pasts into which he could look. Ahriman was right, of course. There was no sign of the taint on Keita. He had seen as much before, but couldn't shake the suspicion that there had been more to it than that. This little investigation had proven him wrong. Keita had acted alone. That was the end of it. And now he had an entire criminal organization on his doorstep, howling for his granddaughter's blood. Curse's growling voice cut through his reverie. Father, if you will allow it, I promised Kali that I would be there when she needed me. The Emperor looked up sharply, but withheld his rage. Very well, Conrad. Do be sure to tell your daughter what you've found, regarding Isis' willingness to see this to its end. Do not, however, make mention of the chaotic element you found. She's scarred enough. I agree. Conrad bowed shortly, backing out of the office. The door closed behind him, leaving Ahriman alone with the Emperor. The Emperor slowly stood, but before he could speak, Ahriman took a knee. My liege. I feel that I must ask you something, he said. I know that the taint of chaos we have found was not the causative factor behind this catastrophe. Is it possible that my own sight is tainted? Was I a lead on this hunt? The Emperor stared at the librarian, his disgust rising. If that is the case, Seer Ahriman, counsel is not what you need from me. Now, abandon this foolish quest. See to your students. And never take it upon yourself to perform interrogation upon my citizens ever again. As you will it, my liege, Ahriman said, feeling the hand of shame clenching around his heart. This shrine of ruin you found, the Emperor said next, glaring furiously at the librarian. It was a decoy. It was. Not a hint of the taint on it, Ahriman admitted. It was just decoration, as far as we can tell. Or a taunt. The Emperor's hands gripped the envelope of reports. A taunt? So I sense. Ahriman shrugged uncomfortably. Then perhaps, Brother Ahriman, you should spend a little time in the company of Lord Magnus, who will, no doubt, be quite willing to aid you in the clearing of your ethereal senses, the Emperor retorted. The mere existence of an icon of chaos in my city suggests that there is far more to this gang than we thought, and even if they are dupes, somebody here knows its source, he added, a quiet anger at the affront coloring his words. I shall indeed, my liege, and I agree entirely, Ahriman said, bowing respectfully. I shall meditate on this with my soul cleansed of distraction. Then I suggest you wait until the school year ends, Azak, since your obligations to your students ends in a few days, and I am more than capable of following this up on my own, the Emperor said angrily. Ahriman bowed contritely. So it shall be, my liege, thank you for your understanding. Ahriman took his leave, as the Emperor slid the reports into his desk, clenching a fist. After a moment's introspection, he stood, the confrontation forcing an uncomfortable realization upon him. He had dispensed the punishments the situation called for. Now, it was time to make amends. Morticia leaned on the railing of her bed, testing her weight. With an effort, she swung her bare legs over the edge and stood, gripping the stainless steel bar tight. Grant clutched her arm, helping her balance, until she nodded, and he backed up a bit. Okay, ready? He asked through his mask. Yep, let's go, she said. He marveled at her resilience. Her voice was almost back to normal after less than a week. He gently guided her across the room to the small bathroom at the end, and helped her ease in, closing the door behind her. While she saw to her needs, he quickly changed the bed and swapped out several IV bags. He was just finishing the sterilization of the IV feed when the bathroom opened back up. Morticia took a few steps towards the bed, then paused and accepted Grant's help on the return trip. Okay, ready, Mom? He asked, leaning over. By means of response, she swung herself over the rail by herself, just remembering to tug her surgical dress into place to preserve her modesty. Grant smiled behind his mask. "You're recovering faster than any patient I've ever seen," he said. "Thanks," she said happily. She grabbed the pillow on the table beside her and gingerly slid it down behind herself. "What time is lights out around here?" she asked. "I've usually gone back under before then." "Well, we're technically past it now," Grant said. "It's supposed to be 2200 local. And tonight, no sedatives unless I need them, right?" she asked. "No, not anymore, Mom. I suspect that your biology would reject them at this point anyway," Grant said. "Yes. Did I ever tell you about that?" "It might be important," Morticia asked. She irritably flipped her lank gray hair back out of her eyes. "I need a haircut." "No, my lady, you didn't," Grant said. "Please call me Morticia, Grant." "There's nothing noble about me right now," Morticia said. Grant fidgeted in professional confusion for a moment before acceding to the instruction. "I'll forget a few times, I promise, but very well, Morticia." "Great. Then I think you should know that I'll probably be up for a few more hours." "You need your rest, Mom," Grant pointed out. That was fast. "Morticia. Sorry. Well, I'm not human," Morticia said with a shrug. "We don't need as much sleep." Grant stared. "I'm sorry? I'm not baseline. I told you yesterday, remember?" Morticia prompted. "All of us are genomoded." "I see. And nocturnal behavior is part of it?" Grant asked. "Basically." An uncomfortable silence followed. "Well, madam, Morticia, I think of course that you should do what makes you most comfortable." "I'll tell me what would make me more comfortable. Solid food," Morticia said emphatically. "I would imagine," Grant said, making a note. "I'll see what I can do." Mortarian watched the news from his office, seething. The head Dujor was talking about how Azakaraman, of all people, had been sighted with, surprise, surprise, the Night Haunter. In the hives below the palace, no less. "Subtle," Mortarian said bitterly. "Yes. Subtle indeed." He fumed at the holograph before stabbing the display with a finger, switching it off. He glanced at the clock. The tiny digital readout said 2230. He swept his personal belongings into his satchel and swung it up, determined to visit his daughter again before he went home. She should have still been up. Grant returned to Morticia's room, shaking his head ruefully. "My apologies, Morticia, but your case file says no solid food for a bit longer." "Damn. I'm getting tired of this liquid stuff," Morticia said ruefully. "Still, thanks for checking." "No problem, Mom, Morticia. Sorry." Morticia grinned as the nurse visibly shook himself. "Is there anything else I can do for you?" "Actually, do you know how the case is going so far?" "They won't let me watch the news," Morticia asked. "I'm sorry, I don't," Grant replied. "The news is mostly biography and speculation. The Arbites are keeping it quiet for now." Mortarian stepped from his limousine to the cold concrete of the garage, brooding. "I will return in some time." "Don't bother leaving the car running," he muttered to the driver. "As you say, my lord," the driver said, rolling the window up. Mortarian ignored him, walking into the hospital, acknowledging the salutes of the guards with a distant wave. The waiting elevator carried him down to where his daughter was resting. Morticia chuckled. "I think I would probably be best served by a news blackout. I don't want to just make myself too anxious." Grant smiled. "I'm very glad you've been able to keep yourself in good spirits, Morticia. I know it can be tempting to get into a spiral of despair after such an incident." She shrugged slightly. "Not much else to do but think about how badly I want to leave," Morticia said. "But thanks." A loud rap on the window caught both their attention. Mortarian was hovering behind it like a green thundercloud. Grant glanced over at Morticia, catching a nod from her, before moving to the door. No sooner had he opened it than the Mortarian was inches from his face. "Your conduct, nurse, has been highly inappropriate," Mortarian bit off. "Every single time I've seen you here,
You've been acting rather casually towards my daughter. By her specific request, my lord, as you are welcome to ascertain, Grant said curtly. Without another word, he turned on his heel and walked out of the isolation room. Mortarion glared daggers at his back until the door closed behind him. Dad, quit it, Morticia said. Her voice carried through the glass to Mortarion's superhuman ears. He's really nice. Too casual for someone whose responsibilities involve tending to royalty, Mortarion said coldly, tapping the speech button on the window. Too bad, Morticia said with a glare. He's a very bright guy. He's not being inappropriate at all. Mortarion seethed, but couldn't find the spite to argue with his daughter. Fine. How are you feeling? Better, Morticia said. She raised her hands, moving them normally. No nerve damage at all. The doctors say I should be able to walk on my own really soon. Good, Mortarion said, his tension fading a little. An encouraging sign. Jake noted the black hovercar outside the lot near his home with a jump of his pulse. Snatching up his bag, he parked in his usual spot and nearly leaped out, jogging back to his apartment. Pushing the door open, he was greeted by the sight of his mother and Venus giggling their hearts out over a hello mag, while father was hovering nearby and trying to look stern. His heart sank. Hi, everybody, Jake said. Hi, Jake, Venus said, suppressing a laugh with great difficulty. His mother coughed once, slapping a hand over her mouth to fight off her own giggles. How was it? I thought I did perfectly, Jake said, walking over to the group. Now I'm not sure. Or, I'm sure you did fine, Sandra said. Thanks. What's so funny? He asked self-consciously. George sighed. I don't think it's funny. You were laughing, Venus accused. Yeah, but at least I had the good sense to be ashamed of it afterwards, he grumbled. Jake stared. What? Here, Venus said, handing him the hello mag with a giggle. You look good. Well, that's a given. But, Jake trailed off as the hello mag picture came into focus. It was him, in his school clothes, walking around the palace gardens with Venus, not 2 days before. What? Must have been a long-range camera in one of the skykas near the palace, Venus said. It happens, she said with another giggle. Look at the headline. Jake glanced it over with apprehension. Comma mystery consort? What the flailing fuck? Ah ha 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 ha. His mother laughed, grabbing the edge of the counter for support. Oh my god, the look on your face. Mom, this isn't funny. Jake said angrily, dropping the hello mag down on the polished plastic surface. I don't want to be in a tabloid. Oh, it'll pass, once Vicky gets her latest fling, I'm sure, Venus said. But for now, enjoy the envy of the rest of the planet while it lasts, she said airily, tossing her hair back over her shoulder with a prim little flick. Sure, Jake grumbled. He paged through the article with one finger, skimming the contents. So they don't know where I live. Good. He kept reading until he reached the end of the small article. How macabre. Morticia's still hospitalized, and they're already verizing her cousins. Well, more specifically, you, Venus said, batting her eyes innocently. Ugh. Jake pushed the mag away. Well, anyway. As long as the school year ends soon, I can live with it. As long as they don't follow us to Kalthree. He whipped his head around to stare at Venus. They won't. Right? Of course they will. It's their jobs, Venus said. They're not going to harass us at the apartment, are they? Jake asked, crestfallen. Venus gave a sly little grin. Sure, for the first few days. To their own embegurment. A few beehives and a fire drake or two will put that sort of behavior to rest in a hurry. Well, that at least sounds fun, Jake said. George picked up the hello mag and started reading it. I guess I can look forward to the show. Hey. Venus stood from the seat at the counter and hiked her jacket across her shoulders. How did the presentation go, for real? Well enough. They liked the topic. Support structures for the mentally disabled in private schools, Jake said. The speech was rough. I was the only one who didn't have a custom holographic diorama or something. but they liked the envelopes. Yeah, that was a nice touch, Venus said. Mine was preservation versus removal of statutes of detention from Terran civic law. Right single quotation mark. Very brave of you, Sandra said. Nobody seems to want to talk about that. Yeah, well, I've never been one to shy from controversy. Just ask my mystery consort, she said sweetly. Oh, for fuck's sake, Jake growled. I'm never gonna hear the end of this, am I? Nope, Venus said cheerfully. Cora let her feet hang from the edge of the spire, feeling the sunshine on her face. Eyes closed under her shades, he listened to the omnipresent hum of passing vehicles, and wondered about when she would be obligated to step in. Romilia hadn't been in school today. She had said she would have been, and she wasn't. What did it mean? Had Freya's typically blunt confrontation failed? Had she hurt herself? Or did she just not feel safe at school? The hot spring winds swept across her skin, a sign of the hotter summer to come. She tugged her jacket off, leaving her arms bare. Her skin was as white as the clouds overhead, in contrast to the dappled gray, white, black, and navy blue dacre of the spire. In the white vest and school skirt of Imperator, she was almost invisible against the white trim of the building, except for the long black hair she splayed around her head as she lay back down. Her vox was off. Her implants were on low power mode. She was incommunicado, and she was on top of the tallest building around, with the exception of the hive wall against which the spire was backed up. She had the sky to herself. More or less. With a long-suffering sigh, she grabbed a few specks of gravel off of the top of the building, letting them run through her fingers back onto the building top. She watched them fall through the nearly opaque lenses of her glasses, seeing every tumble and turn with her gifted eyes. Her father's eyes. Her jaw tightened a bit as her frustration returned. She did her best thinking up here. It was warm, it was beautiful, it was quieter, and best of all, thanks to the impermeable hollow screen of the building and low-flight ceiling of the neighborhood, it was the best place to steal a quick rendezvous with her friends and sisters if needed, or a boyfriend if she was feeling more salacious. Her lips twitched into a smile as she let herself remember the last time she had done that, and the thrill as she had surrendered to his gentle touch. At the moment, though, she had the roof to herself, and her thoughts. Unlike the vast patches of blue overhead, however, her thoughts were unclear. She grabbed a few more specks of rock again, watched them fall back down. Romilia's quiet pain was distracting her. She knew it. She wanted her to get better. They all did. So what could she do? What would your father have said? She asked the air. What would Rogel have done? The air didn't answer. She lay in silence, letting the light from the sun sink into her skin, never darkening it. It couldn't overcome her biology. She sat up as inspiration struck. Could she help Romilia that way? Get her to overcome her own self-destructive tendencies? A streak of gray and red appeared over the blurred lines of cars in the distance. Cora squinted to make it out, grabbing nervously at her jacket, but then she relaxed. She knew who it was. The streak passed through the hollow screen with a suddenness that always startled her. The blur faded into total clarity in an instant. Angela, complete with her custom rocket pack, resolved at the head of the exhaust trail, hovering to a halt above the Raven's daughter. Nice entrance, Cora said casually, coughing through the updraft of the engines. Rocket pack travel was the pastime of the obscenely rich, even here in Starlight, but for Angela, it was more like a way of life. Given her heritage, who was surprised? Sorry about that, Angela said, disengaging the jets. Cora, as one would expect of a Raven Guard's daughter, had an appreciation for rocket packs. She looked over the one Angela was wearing with undisguised envy, watching its flaps retract, the coils of smoke from the engines disappear on the wind. Angela unclipped the harness and hefted the pack down on the roof, fluttering her wings to work out the cramps. How are you feeling? A bit dusty, now, but largely okay. Cora cocked an eyebrow behind her mirrored shades. Yourself? Great. I had a morning speech, so it was cake, Angela said brightly. I suspect I aced it. Yeah? Good for you, Cora said, leaning back on the rooftop. Mine's the very last one.
in the whole class. Ouch. That's Friday? Angela asked. Yep, Cora sighed. My topic's a boring one too. I thought it would be fun, but it's so dry. What? Effects of preconditioned deorbiting of non-metallic orbital wreckage, Cora sighed. Also, less pretentiously, known as blowing up shit in space. Right single quotation mark. Angela laughed. Cora smiled quite without meaning too. Her cousin's laugh was infectious. So, Angela, what brings you over? Well, I just wanted to make sure you were okay, and to see if you had any plans to drop back in on Morticia, Angela said, sitting down beside her cousin. I'm fine. Why wouldn't I be? Cora asked. Angela shrugged, her feathers twitching in the wind. I dunno. The thing with Morticia's been hard on all of us, and I know you and Kelly were closer than she was to me. I guess. Cora peeked a brow again. What about you? You're looking awfully saccharine. Angela flushed furiously, and looked away, into the wind. Cora wondered what she could have said to provoke such a reaction. Perhaps a touchy nerve? What? She giggled. Nothing, Angela said into the wind. Can't hear you, Cora lied. Angela glanced back at her, tugging the red leather of her jacket's collar a bit higher. Nothing. Cora's eyes picked a line of tiny red spots on her cousin's neck out against the glare, and smiled knowingly. Angela flushed again. It's not that visible, is it? Not unless you're looking, Cora said. This time it was true. Lucky girl. Cora. What? I'm happy for you. But seriously, back to the topic at hand. When are we dropping in next time? Cora asked. We aren't. Not as a group. I meant individually. Oh. Well, after school on Friday I'm studying with Freya for finals, but after that I might go by. Great. Angela proclaimed. She stood back up, effortlessly balancing her weight with her natural counterbalances. Sorry if I, made you uncomfortable. Cora waved it off. I brought it up. Yeah, I know. Angela fidgeted. Sorry, you want privacy, she said, picking her pack up. No, Cora sighed. I want answers. How do I stop Furia and Romilia from hurting themselves? Angela grimaced, setting the pack back down. She stood in silence, then walked over to where Cora was still lying, sitting down next to her. I don't know. Furia, she's already stopped. Simon threatened to end it, right there, when he found out. Said it was a slap in the face. Her father nearly blew a gasket when he found out, too. A slap in the face? Cora asked. Simon's little hospital journey. Remember? It was some drug peddler from. Right. Cora thought that over. She glanced up at her cousin from her back. The sun was glinting off of the zip on Angela's jacket, and the glare almost hid the look of intent concentration on her face. HMPH. And Romilia? She sucks at hiding it. She didn't even come to school today. I think she's stopped too, but I don't know why she wasn't at school, Angela said. You know who else wasn't? We had a substitute for warp studies. Angela looked down at her cousin. Yeah? No Ironman? Nope. Some random sub. Ha. He got in deep shit for that little stunt with Conrad, Angela pointed out. Maybe he had somewhere else to be. Maybe. I bet Grandpa was livid, Cora snorted. He was. I don't think I've ever felt him that angry, Angela whispered. Not from that close. Cora looked up at her, blinked in surprise. Angela's face was haunted, her eyes focused on something far below. Were you there? Cora asked. No, I was in the same wing of the palace but nowhere near him, Angela said. I went back to him to get some advice on something after the rest of you went home. Whoa. What did it look like? Cora asked earnestly. Psychic phenomena fascinated her. Some part of her envied Miranda's and Angela's powers, even though she knew the risks were still huge, even now. Scary. Everything went all twisty, Angela said. The lines that hold everything together got shaky. They weren't going to break, though. That was really obvious. Still kinda scary. Cora nodded sympathetically, her cousin's attempt to describe the warp percolating through her head. "Well, don't let it spook you," she advised. She balled up her jacket and stuck it under her head like a pillow. "I can't even imagine what it would have looked like up close." "Miranda might have seen it in more detail," Angela continued. "She's way more powerful than me, now."
"Really?"
"I'm a beta, she's an alpha plus," Angela explained. "Holy shit." Cora propped herself up on her elbows to get a look at her cousin. Angela squirmed a bit under the scrutiny. "What does it feel like?"
"What?"
"Looking into the warp," Angela asked. Cora nodded, speechless. "Oddly comforting, sometimes. When I'm near another sicker, it kinda feels good. But if I'm not, or if there's a huge outburst of emotion nearby, it's really chaotic." "That's so cool." "It can be, yeah," Angela allowed. "What do people look like?"
"People look sort of indistinct when I'm just looking at them. Like, I can see them perfectly clearly, but,
Angela struggled for a metaphor. "Before my power manifested, I saw people normally. Then my powers awakened, and people look the same, but if they have a little psychic power in them, they glow a bit. I can hear them clearer, even if my normal ears are working fine. And if they have anti-psychic power, they're a little darker. I can hear them fine, but they look a little dark. Really emotional people glow in colors. And a really powerful sicker like Dad or Miranda, they glow so bright that it's impossible to ignore them. But it's not blinding either. It actually feels more like, Angela pursed her lips and rubbed her hands together.
"Like what?"
Cora asked. Angela glanced down and grinned. Cora was up on both elbows, spellbound. Like a tiny hole in a piece of metal. It lets some light through so you can see, but as long as you don't stare into it as hard as you can, you're not going to be blinded. So like that, only it's in every direction.
"What does it feel like?"
"That must be distracting," Cora put in.
"Not at all.
It's more like if you're trying to read something and someone turns a light on behind you. It's clearer. It's helpful."
"What about Malkader or Grandpa?"
"They glow so bright it's amazing. And Uncle Magnus too. It's breathtaking. Even Miranda, she's so bright, but it doesn't draw the eye, either. It's just sort of there. Like how you might notice if someone has a new haircut, but then you don't even notice after a few minutes. And that's all passive. I don't have to look to see it. If I really stretch, actively look into the warp, everything looks even weirder. I really don't think I can explain it."
"What about that Elder Ambassador? What does he look like?"
Cora asked.
"He's super bright. Like a bonfire. Light pouring out everywhere. But it's more directed. A human sicker is sending light out everywhere. Elder look more focused. They only send light where they want to. It's really alien."
"They're aliens," Cora said sagely.
"Yeah. But being near a human sicker with that kind of power feels really good. Like stepping into a hot bath on a frigid day. It's incredibly comforting. There's a soul here, and it's really complex, and it's so bright. It's tempered by people's emotions, too. And when I'm near Grandpa, the whole world feels straighter. Even the ripples in the warp from the passage of time calm down."
"That sounds like it can be a lot of fun," Cora said wistfully. Angela's face darkened.
"Not when you're near someone with bad waves going on," she said.
"What? Someone really angry? Or scared? Or nervous? Or apprehensive? Or bitter? Or if you're near someone who's dying? That's terrifying. There's a little ball of light inside them, and it's going out, and you want to grab it and put it back in, but it's going, and you can't stop it," Angela said darkly. "And if you look into the warp at just right time, you can see the soul there. The mind's gone, the bodies meet, there's just this tiny little ball of emotion and pain, and then it's gone, swept away by wind. If they're lucky. If they're not, it lingers, lost, confused, terrified, hurt, so deeply hurt. And if they're really unlucky, chump," she said, slamming her hands together.
"Eaten intact.
And aware of it too."
"Holy hell, Angela, that's awful. Cora said, utterly aghast. Eaten by what? Take a guess, Angela said, a little horror creeping into her voice. She looked down at her cousin, and somehow, a smile crept onto her lips. See, though, that feels good. You saw I was getting scared, and you wanted me to feel better. Subconsciously. And you changed colors a little, and your soul moved a bit closer. That feels really good. The benefits outweigh the costs, believe me. Cora was a bit taken aback. All right, wait. When did you see someone dying? At the hospital, before, Angela said. One floor up. And when I was there to see Furia and Simon at one time. That was in the room right next to Simon's. I don't know how Uncle Magnus managed to stay focused. That one wasn't so bad since he, the guy who died, I mean, he knew it was his time. Sedated. He just kinda went out. That's not so bad. Ha. Cora seemed to be thinking over the mountain of information Angela had given her, then suddenly blinked and recoiled a bit as she realized her deific cousin was staring down at her with a knowing grin. Keep it to yourself, she mumbled. I mean, it's none of my business. I don't mind, Angela laughed. It's really peaceful. Blissfully relaxing. Nearly fell asleep once. What? Cora giggled despite the mood. You nearly fell asleep mid-boink. Yeah. You think having an arm fall asleep feels nasty, Angela grumbled, jerking a thumb over her shoulder at her folded wings. Cora pitched her head back and laughed. Her voice carried over the edge of the colossal building, bouncing off the hive wall in a musical echo. It wasn't that funny, Angela said after her cousin's hysterics faded. That, naturally, launched her into another bout of giggles. See, now I don't feel quite so envious, Cora managed. Angela looked down at her in mock exasperation as her laughter finally faded. Feel better? Much, Cora sighed happily. Mission accomplished, Angela declared. She stood up again, snugging the rocket pack over her wings, and smiled down at her black-haired cousin. You know you can talk to me whenever, right? I know, Cora smiled gratefully up at her. It means a lot to me, but I'm not sure I'm ready yet. You know? It still kind of stings. College, Angela said, tugging her gloves on. It'll salve the hurt. Is that a prophecy? Cora joked. Yes, Angela said, shocking her cousin. She took off without another word, plummeting several dozen stories down the side of the spire, before leveling off and streaking into the distance. Cora watched her until she suddenly lost resolution behind the hollow field. She smiled to herself, leaning back on the jacket bundle, and twirling a tiny sliver of gravel between her fingers. Thanks, she whispered to the morning wind. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app, and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Confession of guilt. Grant finished his checklist, exhaustion pulling at his eyes. His shift was nearly over, and he was ready to go home. The last, and in fact only, patient on the floor was Morticia, and after the confrontation between him and her father the shift before, he was in little mood for any distractions. Opening her door, he noted with relief that she was feeling well. She was busily reading a Hello Mag when he walked in, and immediately looked up and smiled as he walked in. Hi, Grant. Sorry my father put the fear in you, before. I understand his concerns, Morticia. Fear not, Grant said. Trust me, he wasn't the first jealous parent I've had to deal with. Morticia's eyes sparkled with some hidden mischief, which she kept to herself. Really? Well,
I may be having another guest later tonight, sorry. That'll be somewhat difficult, since the hospital's now closed, Grant said. He unhooked the last Ive bag on the tree and placed it on his cart, completing his tasks. That didn't stop him, I see, Morticia said happily, gesturing over Grant's shoulder. He glanced over to the waiting room, where a group of three men were discussing something with the Death Guard serf. I'm done, now, actually, so I'll leave you to it, Grant said, wheeling the cart out. See you tonight. See you then, she said, putting the hello mat down and feeling a tremor of nerves race through her stomach. Grant wheeled the cart past the cluster of men in the middle of the room, noting that they stopped their discussion as he went by. One rather gaunt man stopped him with a question. Nurse, is she comfortable enough to speak? She should be, sir, but she's quite tired, Grant said, wondering which branch of the royal family this one represented. Of course. I won't be long, I suspect, he said, bowing his head for a moment. As you will, sir, Grant said wearily, wheeling the cart to the hallway and starting down towards the elevator. That's the one Lord Mortarion told me to watch, sire, the serf told the Emperor and his companions. They're entirely too close. I'll see to it, the Emperor promised, letting his sorceress disguise dissolve. In a moment, the aura of power that surrounded him flooded the room, lighting its corners and banishing the shadows from the window. His true appearance restored, the serf began to take a knee, before a gesture stopped him. I will be as discreet as possible. Please do not allow anyone else in behind me. As you so command it, my liege, the serf said reverently. The two custodes librarians behind him, son their more visible accoutrements of office, quietly stood to the sides of the door into the isolation room. Morticia grinned widely as the Emperor walked into the isolation room. Grandpa. I hoped you would make it. I would have come the instant I heard, had the Arbites not needed me to hold their hands throughout the ordeal, the Emperor groused. I assure you, I would not have delayed otherwise. Are you feeling better? Yep, Morticia said, overlooking the weakness of his statement. I can walk now, and the Ives come out tonight. Excellent, the Emperor said, smiling fondly. He stopped at the foot of the bed, shaking his head at the state of things. My dear child. I cannot tell you how much it pains me to see you hurt so gravely. Grandpa, believe me, it's worse on this end, she said, smiling gamely. The Emperor returned the smile despite himself, coming around to half sit on the edge of the bed. I would imagine so. It's not a fun experience, is it? You've been shot too? Morticia asked. The Emperor laughed shortly, rolling his left sleeve back to reveal a circular scar on the back of his hand. A few times. Oh wow. Still, my child, I'm built for it, and you aren't. Is there anything I can do to help? Perhaps that nurse Mortarion dislikes so much must be replaced? Morticia huffed impatiently. Grandpa, he's a great guy, and he's been completely professional. I should sincerely hope so, the Emperor said sternly. I put him through the most rigorous background check of any position I've tried to fill since I appointed the High General of the TPDF. Well, he's been really nice, and he doesn't treat me like I'm made of acid-laden ceramic cups, so Dad can deal with it, Morticia said primly. The Emperor grinned. I'm glad. His smile faded as his transhuman eyes followed the grotesque map of scars on her body. Morticia, my dear girl, I am sorry. Stop it. Neither you, nor the treasury, nor the custodes, nor the Arbites, nor Dad, nor the army of praetors and enforcers that I've seen since I got shot are remotely responsible for this. One asshole with more ideology than common sense did this, Morticia said firmly. He worships me as a god, Morticia, the Emperor said softly. I have never felt such shame. Morticia's eyes softened, and her shoulders slumped. Please stop. Okay. For me? I will try. The Emperor went silent, his eyes inscrutable. Do you know why your Uncle Conrad and his Eliaramen went into the depths of the city last night? Because Uncle Conrad is paranoid? Morticia sighed. Well, that's true, yes.
But they are convinced that there is more to Kita's motivations than ideological blindness, the Emperor said. I don't know, Morticia said, shifting her shoulders. I think I'd be more comfortable with there being nothing more to it than one psycho. The Emperor nodded. It would be disingenuous of me to say that I have not harbored similar doubts. But their investigation, if you can call it that, turned up nothing. For now, I shall continue to view the Arbite's theory as accurate. Morticia shrugged uncomfortably. Your call, Grandpa. Do I have to attend the trial? Technically, you must do so only if you are healed enough to make it safely. So, yes, you do, the Emperor regretfully replied. Okay. Morticia peered up at him with her odd gray eyes. You look like you have something else to say. I do. The Emperor, for the first time in a long while, found himself struggling for his words. After a moment's internal debate, rather more of a literal concept than it was for most people, he decided the story needed to be told in full. Morticia, do you know the true reason I created you and your sisters? The true reason? Morticia asked, with the sense of creeping dread that had haunted her lately wending its way back through her stomach. I guess not. Unless there's more to you wanting our fathers to have something to come back to. Oh, that was entirely factual, make no mistake of it. The Emperor thought back to those chaotic, trying days of ceaseless conflict. Your father, all the Primarchs, in fact, whether they saw it or not, were exhausted. I had driven them and their legions to conquer as much space as the bounds of the Astronomicon allowed. Millions of planets, well over 1.2 million stars. The Imperium was much, much larger than I had originally thought it would be. Our alliance with the Elder helped. Our brave houses of the Navigators helped. But, there were supposed to be 21 of them. 21 super soldiers, all guiding humanity to its rightful, glorious future. Then my uncles died, Morticia supplied. Yes. Then your uncles did something so monumentally stupid, so unforgivably foul, that your uncles Lemon and Robout had to put pay to them. The Emperor closed his eyes in remorse. I may never forgive myself for allowing their weakness to persist as long as it did. But the survivors, those of your uncles who remained, and your father, they had to divide the responsibility of governing the Imperium up amongst themselves. Had they received the tutelage I had planned for them when I began, it does not matter. We found ways. The Emperor tilted his head back and stared into space. We created councils and counselors, and counselors too, and admirals and lord commanders, and we divided up space like a puzzle. As the warp storms receded, more and more worlds came back into the fold. We conquered them too, and the legions expanded alongside the army, and the navy, and all the branches of my military. He looked down at his granddaughter and smiled. I knew that even the supermen I had created would need a reason to stop fighting someday. Some reward. Some motivation. Not just to lay down the swords, but to want to never pick them up again. So I gathered my scientists, a fresh batch this time. I repaired my long-neglected gene labs on Luna and Terra, and I got to work. In the interim, I sent my sons to the edges of space, to take and fortify the systems at the outermost reaches of the Astronomicon's light. I even added more seats to the choir of the beacon, at the heart of the Astronomicon, so that its range would be increased, beyond its point of diminishing returns. Until the Imperium was as physically large as it could be. And while they fought, I worked. Morticia shifted on her mattress, a little uncomfortable, but listening enrapt. The Emperor stood, started pacing. My confidant, Elder Deltron, perhaps the one person left in the galaxy at that point whose powers of foresight eclipsed mine, warned me against my initial plan to tap the webway and turn it into a teleportation network for the legions. He saw the device I had reclaimed to serve as its core, and found its flaws. Instead of relying on it to become a psychic gateway for me, we turned it into the core of the project we dubbed the Carpe Noctem Experiment. That's High Gothic for Seize the Night, isn't it? Morticia asked. It is. Four Elder Farsiers and myself, we journeyed to the very, very edge of the Astronomicon, where several Elder Craft Worlds were looking to establish permanent colonies for their people. There,
We entered the golden orb, the device that would have powered my webway portal, and used it to create a psychic bridge between the core of the resurgent Elder Empire and Terra, such that webway all know, all travel on that pathway would be orders of magnitude faster. Whoa. What went wrong? Morticia asked, wide-eyed. The Emperor blinked, his speech interrupted. Nothing. Nothing went wrong. It's there now, still fully operational. Morticia winced in chagrin. Oh. I thought you were building up to something. I am, the Emperor said with a grin. He sat back down, looked his granddaughter in the eye, and continued. You see, the Primarchs thought that that signaled the end of the crusade. It wasn't, of course. I had much more in mind. As soon as the bridge was declared safe, I returned to Terra, and I instructed my scientists to begin work on, well, you. I sent the Primarchs to their legionary worlds, and to recruit their numbers back up to full. When you and the other royal daughters were completed, I sent word for your fathers to come to Terra and receive their reward for completing the work I had set out for them. Reward, Morticia echoed, stone-faced. Well, not in so many words. But I will not deny that I was proud of them. The Emperor's face lifted slightly at the memory. You cannot imagine the glory we felt. A million star systems, more, united by our force of arms, our technology, our creed, our species. Well, how did the Primarchs take it? Morticia asked. The Emperor's good spirits vanished. Well, to be fair, I didn't really use your life, the lives of your sisters, as collateral. I can see that you're thinking along those lines. Kinda hard not to, Morticia said, distantly offended. I see. The Emperor sighed heavily. Then I will be frank. When I recalled them and declared, at that private ceremony, that the crusade was over, several were relieved, even before I said anything else. They knew. They're bright lads, you know. Some more than others, sure, Morticia joked. The Emperor smiled, quite involuntarily. I would never say that, he chided gently. Anyway. Your Uncle Robout, for instance, had had enough of killing. He wanted to govern. Perturabo, less so, but he did as well. Rogal, and Fulgrim, and even Lorga, they wanted to lead people, to be teachers and princes, not just generals. Vulcan, he was happy at war. He found comforts in it. But had just wed, anticipating my recall, and took to it gladly. Lemon wanted to start a family, too, I think. So did Korax. But the other Primarchs, including your father, I am sorry to say, did not. They wanted to keep fighting, forever, if need be. Or, at least, they could not think of themselves as anything but fighters. Dad didn't want me? Morticia asked, stunned. Please, never say that. Not to me, not to him, not to anyone, not even yourself, the Emperor said, his face darkening. I said that I wanted them to start families before I said I had already created them. Or parts of them. He had no idea you existed when he said he did not want a family. But, Morticia said weakly. The Emperor was devastated. The girl was clearly crestfallen. Please, please, let me finish, Morticia, he asked, his voice rising. Your father was quiet. He said little. It was certain others of your uncles who objected. I will not say which. But they did, and they said that they would be horrible parents, and horrible husbands, and so on. I let them voice their opinions, and I did listen to them. Then, those who had said nothing were asked their opinions. The Emperor lifted his hand, palm open. When Horus asked Magnus what he thought of fatherhood, he surprised us all. He said he couldn't wait. Vulcan and Lorga chimed in. Lion too. They had thus far been quiet. The Emperor closed his hand, letting a tiny bead of golden light play along it. We were all a little stunned. When asked why, each said the same thing. They wanted legacy. The Emperor clenched his fist, extinguishing the light. His eyes pierced Morticia's. She recoiled, surprised by his fervor. Your father, he came to think of you not as a burden, to restrain him from doing his role as a leader of the Imperium, but as a model. He wanted to make the best Imperium he could for you to live in. And Vulcan, and Lorga, and Lion, and all of them, they were told, by me, by their own consciences, by their old cultures, by whatever they listened to make the best Imperium to live in. He stood, his eyes ablaze. I had instructed them, Morticia, and carefully too, to create the best Imperium in which the species could survive. Now, I wanted it to thrive. I wanted the leaders of the Imperium to find their company of noble wives and brilliant, beautiful daughters, and to find a new contentment. I made them ambitious, Morticia, so ambitious, because they had to be. Because I wanted them to be driven by a desire to conquer. But now there were no conquests left. Not unless I wanted to rip open the warp or the webway and send them in after the monsters that reside therein, which I will never do. I wanted their instincts to be honed and focused on you, on making the best worlds they could build. And how is that different from what I had already been told? Morticia asked, resentment fading into genuine confusion. Aside from the thing about her uncles taking it poorly, it wasn't anything she had not already known. The Emperor sank back down into the bedside, his eyes losing their fire. Because, Morticia, there is more. When I created the Primarchs, I made mistakes. I committed errors. I built flaws. You know them. They know them. I shall not list them here. But they are there. He took up her hand, squeezing her cold flesh in his own hand. Morticia, when I created the Primarchs, and the Custodes, and the Legions, the very first genocide was contaminated. Those flaws are not supposed to be there. And 3,600 years is a very, very long time. The end of the crusade came upon us slowly, but come it did. I no longer had the luxury of rooting out old errors. When I created you, and your dear sisters, I simply reused a modified version of the original genocide, methods and all. He stood, still holding her hand, and crouched by the bedside, bringing his eyes down to hers. Her face was locked in a mask of complete astonishment. Morticia, my dear girl, I must ask your forgiveness for three things here. He closed his eyes, finding his words. The first mistake is not preventing the sort of ideologues that spawn vermin like Keter from existing. I have the power, you know. If I felt the need, I could send an army without limit into the hives, scour them down to metal and stone, and start over. Erase every single mention of me as anything other than a politician. You know why I do not. Beyond common human decency, I know what that could trigger. I know what I would become. But I have the power to keep people like Keter from existing, and I do not use it. Will you forgive me? Morticia stared. Forgive you, for what? Not being a bloodthirsty, tyrannical, despotic, genocidal executioner? Why would you even ask? Of course. The Emperor nodded once, acknowledging her statement. Thank you. The second thing I have heard is more personal. I viewed your creation as necessary. I still do. I do not regret it, and by and large, neither do your uncles. You know your father doesn't. So, the problem of your core genocide remains. When I created you, I used genocide from which the taint had not, could not be completely erased. If I had not, you would not exist as you are, do not mistake it. If I had used pure genocide, you would be nothing more or less than a female custodian. But you would be whole. No scarred lungs. No wings. No third eyes. No burning visage and endless flames under the skin. You would not be cursed with the same mutancy that the contamination forced on your fathers. So, will you forgive me? Morticia leaned back in her bed, a sense of absolutely surreal disconnection filling her. Grandpa, I'm no more or less perfect than any other human. And I think, if you had gotten clones of yourself, you would have resented it later. Of course I forgive you. He nodded again. Then, he felt his breath catch in his throat a little. The first two mistakes, he had suspected she would forgive, but the last was much more personal. Morticia, the last mistake is one of which I do not yet think I deserve to be absolved. When I created your fathers, some of their flaws ran deep. I do not speak of mutancy, nor madness, nor overambition,
nor any other affliction of mind or body. I speak of something subconscious, something between the soul and the mind. Flaws of personality, of perception. They are intrinsic parts of who they are, and I have come to know them better for it. Some of them overcame their scattered, piecemeal youths and became better people for it. Others did not. I do not hide it, neither do they. And do not assume that I assigned such flaws or lack thereof to any specific primarch, either, for I've known them far longer than you. But, at some level, Morticia, I allowed my own personal experiences to cloud my judgment. How? Morticia asked, confused. I allowed my expectations, my desires, to alter and distort what I could perceive of their expectations, their desires. Morticia, the addition of the genocide in your creation occurred before I spoke to your fathers. To this day, I do not fully understand my own reasoning. Perhaps I wanted to ensure that they did not say no. Perhaps I wanted to make sure the process was well underway before they were committed. But, Morticia, I think that I also wanted a chance to correct those flaws. Your sister Kelly is not plagued by uncontrollable psychic torment. Your sister Venus is not harmful to the touch. You can breathe without a mask. But the flaws of the mind, I sought to cure those as well. Rather than let your fathers choose, rather than let you choose, I chose for you. Is that any different from random genetics playing dice with normal people? Isn't that really better? Morticia asked, that sense of numbness spreading. It is not, Morticia. I saw in you more than a chance to anchor your fathers. More than a chance to provide them, and indirectly myself, with a legacy. I saw in you, to some extent, a means of starting over, the emperor confessed, regret tightening his throat again. I owed your fathers more than seeing them as a failed experiment. And, I certainly, undeniably, owed you more too. You should be princesses, Morticia, the royal daughters of the species, and the pinnacles of humanity, but my greed, my self-pity, robbed you of that. Your futures will not only be marred by the flaws your fathers could not escape, but will be restrained by my own inability to let a poor result stand. I used genocide I knew to be flawed because I had to know whether I could do better, regarding my ability to guide my offspring to a greater future. He closed his eyes, not to stifle tears, but so that he could not see the tears in her own eyes. I have regretted that decision since the moment Isis looked at me, at a mere 10 months, and spoke her first word. I missed the childhoods of each and every one of the primarchs. They were robbed from me by the machinations of a force beyond my control and your reckoning. But yours, your formative years, the years that imprinted within you the behaviors and personalities that will create your entire lives, they were here, on Terra, within my reach and protection. And even then I did not do enough to ensure that your lives could be safe, could be healthy, could be productive, and most importantly of all, could be filled with the love and the stability that were so uniformly and permanently taken from your fathers. He opened his eyes and met his granddaughters, and now his tears gathered too. I put the lives of 19 innocent, eternal children into the hands of men who had told me outright that they could not be entrusted with them. I forced fatherhood on them as I forced flaws on you, without thinking, without using the one asset I have in greater abundance than any other soul in the entire galaxy save a few, foresight. He tightened his grip on his granddaughter's trembling hand, his vision tracking the exact path the frag had taken through her body, mashing her guts to pulp and pouring forth her blood. He saw the scars already beginning to form on her lungs, not as a result of the air she breathed, but as a result of the damage to mortary in that he didn't, but perhaps could have come to fix. Morticia, every mental and physical and psychological flaw that every single one of your sisters bears is directly, indisputably, my fault. So, I ask now, completely beyond any hope of finding it, will you forgive me? Morticia sobbed, a racking cough seizing her fragile chest. She clamped her hand to her mouth, catching a few drops of blood as they escaped, and wiped her hand on the cloth at the edge of the bed without even thinking consciously. Grandpa, please. Stop. I can't blame you for this. This is not your fault. It is. All of it. If I had waited but a few more years, I could have removed the flaws from the genocides I used to make you.
I could have taken your eternal illness. I could have taken Venus fire. I could have taken Angela's wings and Omegan's crippling self-doubt. But, I did not. And even if I had, even if their personalities had remained intact and whole after the fact, it would have remained stark and undeniable. Fully one-third of your father's wanted daughters only after I gave you to them. Grandpa, how can you ask me to choose? Morticia asked, tears soaking her cheeks. I can't. I can't choose. I can't decide. What option do I have? I could have never had a life at all if you hadn't done it, if I had been a different person. And how much of who we are, she paused to arrest the trickle of blood again, is defined by what we are. Do you know that? I don't. Grandpa, please, don't ask me that. She sank back against the pillows, her eyes clouded with anguish. Grandpa, stop it. I forgive you. How could I not? The Emperor hung his head, letting a tear of his own work its way down his cheek. Again, Morticia, you shame me. And once more, I am selfish. Thank you, my dearest child, thank you so much. Grandpa, she sobbed, squeezing her own hand back against his at last. For a minute or two, the room was silent, save the sound of her crying, until she was all cried out, and restlessness set in. The Emperor slowly stood, his bearing and visage regal once more. Thank you, Morticia. I can see by your soul I have burdened you, here, far more than I had any right to. A task at which I seem remarkably adept. I can stay longer, and so I shall, because if, bucking the trend, I am to learn from this, I must do so now. He sat back down at the side of the bed, earning a smile of weary approval from the gray-eyed girl. Morticia, my dear girl, tell me more about your life, and those of your sisters. I am far too small a part of them, for my liking. Morticia settled back against the pillow, thinking. Well, I think Venus and Freya are thinking of going to visit Nocturne and Fenris after graduation. They want to see what their father's homes were like. Do they? Interesting. Do they know when they will go? College commitments seem to have taken them both, the Emperor noted. Well, yeah, but they won't get another chance for a while, and it's good timing. I don't want to go with them, though, even if I could. I'm thinking of going on a bit of a vacation of my own, if I can, to see Terra a bit more. The cities, the hives, she said, cleaning another ribbon of blood from her mouth. The Emperor nodded, thinking that over. That should prove educational, too, I would hope. I hope so, she responded, and so it went, for over an hour, before duty called the Emperor back to his role, and sleep called Morticia to rest. But the Emperor knew, as he walked back to his motorcade, that her forgiveness had been sincere, and for all he had left unsaid as much as he had said aloud. And that, he supposed, was good enough. Horace stood at the entrance to his daughter's room, watching as she deliberately avoided his gaze. She hadn't come to greet him when he had returned from work the previous night. She had avoided him while getting ready for school that morning. Now, when he had finally cornered her, she had nothing to say. Isis. I want to hear about your little excursion, he said evenly. I nearly got killed by a bunch of genomoded gangers, and it was entirely my own damn fault, Isis said quietly. I marched Julius into a trap and it took the goddamned Night Haunter to save my dumbass. Double quote. Horace raised his eyebrows. Well, I'm glad you said it first. I can't believe it. Isis ground her hands into her eyes, muffling a snarl. Fuck it. I was. Isis. My daughter. I understand exactly why you did it, Quora said, standing back in the door a little. He didn't want to look too imposing. You want there to be something more to this. Do you understand how things have been complicated by your actions? Isis sighed, finally meeting her father's eyes. Yes. Horace nodded slowly. Good. He stood quiet a moment longer, before turning to leave. Dad, what about Julius? Isis asked suddenly. What about him? He fired a hill pistol in public, Horace noted. Would you have me make an exemption to the law for him? Isis clenched her teeth, fighting back her emotions. I don't want him to suffer for trying to do the right thing.
He was protecting us from a murder. He was defending himself and me. Yes, he was. A situation that should have never arisen, resolved by brute force and intimidation, Horace said. His tone never changed. It was driving ISIS crazy. He will go to juvenile court and be tried, found not guilty by means of extenuating circumstances, and go about his life with a mark on his record. A just punishment for his misbehavior. You should feel fortunate you didn't fire that bolt you conveniently forgot to ask to borrow. ISIS's face twisted, her concern for Julius overriding propriety. Dad, please. I don't want Julius to suffer for my bad idea. Was it your idea? Horace asked. Or did he propose it? The question brought ISIS up short. He proposed it, ISIS said. She buried her face in her hands, utterly ashamed. There was no way this was going to work out well, was there? Horace sighed, paternal instinct tugging at his professionalism. ISIS, I assure you that Julius is going to be found not guilty. But he still has to suffer. He has to miss the last weeks of school. He has to miss Morticia's trial. He's going to turn 17 in jail. He might be tried as an adult. ISIS cried. And if I demand that the Arbites make an exception for him, what does that say? Horace asked. What would you have me do? ISIS thought desperately, her mind racing. Can we find an alternative? Something that doesn't leave him with a felony arrest on his record? Community service? Something? Horace stared at his daughter. Community service for willful assault with a deadly weapon? A fine for concealment of an automatic weapon? Ask the judge to take pity on him. Dad, ISIS's eyes welled up in tears. I wouldn't ask if I didn't think this wasn't fair. Horace inhaled deeply, let it out in a rush. I will ask the judge to remove the felony arrest from Julius' record when he is found not guilty. That is the extent of it. ISIS felt a lump of tension in her stomach dissolve. She rose, walking over to her father, and hugged him, overcome. Thank you, Dad, she said faintly. It's the most I can ask, and I won't forget this. I'll do whatever I can to make this up to you. If you mean that, then do me a favor and make it abundantly clear to your friend that my patience has reached its limit, Quora said, all business again. I will never stick my neck out for him again. Don't worry, ISIS said, humor gamely coloring her words. I'm told the pious family never forgets their friends. Purging a wound. Romilia sat down, feeling strangely detached from the world around her. Miranda noticed her discomfort, giving her hand a reassuring squeeze. Just us, Romilia. I know. She flipped her ponytail over her shoulder, glancing from side to side from nerves. When does he get here? When he means to, and not a moment before or after, Miranda said dryly. But don't worry. He knows how much it means to you to get this done quietly. I hope so, Romilia said. Behind her, the door squeaked a bit on its hinges. Romilia started. Magnus the Red walked in, nodding serenely at his daughter as he did so. She beamed a smile back at him, then turned it on her cousin. Should I? If you don't mind, Romilia asked sheepishly. Sure thing, Miranda said. She gave Romilia another squeeze for good measure before standing and heading out through the door her father had used. Magnus turned to face his niece, sitting beside her at the little table in his study. I want to make it clear that I understand the responsibility you're asking me to shoulder, Magnus said by way of greeting. His voice was in the range of bass that could vibrate small objects off of tables, but somehow didn't feel too loud. However, Romilia, I feel I must ask. Why are you asking me for help? Because I'm absolutely ashamed of myself, Romilia said, her voice catching in her throat, sudden bile and hatred clogging her voice. I'm 17 goddamned years old, and I, she slammed her hand down on the table. Magnus watched the display in silence. He could see her soul as plain as day. It was a deep, throbbing red of anger, dashed with yellow of dishonesty. Was she lying to him or herself? Romilia, please. I'm sorry, she said, instantly contrite. The yellow faded. The teal of self-loathing flooded in behind it. Lying to herself. I can help, he said softly,
but I will say now that I am not a doctor. I may not know when I've found the problem. I will, she said coldly. I've had enough. I can't look my father in the eye and tell him that you have done as he asked, Magnus began. Romilia nodded, her eyes locked on the table. And stopped this pointless self-mutilation? Romilia's eyes snapped up, wide and uneasy. Yeah, she breathed. Did Miranda tell you? Magnus took Romilia's hands and flipped them. A tracery of little red scars, most old and faded, too very fresh, webbed the skin. Dear child, these leave marks I don't need both eyes to see, he said gently. Each act of self-destruction scars your soul as deep as your body. Romilia's eyes turned downward again. I know, she said softly. No, you don't, Magnus said coldly, in complete contrast to his demeanor moments ago. Romilia flinched. Romilia, you think of the mind. When you think of a scar one cannot see, you think of the mind, the activities and processes to which and through which your body acts. I speak of the soul, the facet of personality as lasting as the body or the mind can even be. You think of the pains of the mind, the shames and despairs that leave with death, and ease with time. He leaned forward again, and there was something terrible about him. I speak of eternity. Romilia's skin paled as some part of her Genohan's mind started to fully comprehend what her uncle said. He continued, hammering his point home. The body is a vessel, the mind a lens. The soul is a diamond, born by one and empowered by another, until they fade and it is cast adrift, and it rests in limbo. When you draw that knife through your flesh, you damage yourself in a way that cannot be fixed, he thundered. Or so it seemed. In that little room, a whisper would have been a scream, in his voice. Never? Romilia asked, in mounting horror. I am damning myself? Magnus leaned back in his seat. Yes. Your soul already bears its wounds. I can see them as plainly as the scars on your flesh. I can do nothing to erase them? Romilia asked. Her instinct screamed to fight, to avoid the danger, but if what Magnus was saying was true, it was already past. You cannot erase them. You can, however, patch them. The red-headed man nodded slowly. Your father also bears those scars. If he has not told you, I care not. He should have. The moment he sensed your own behavior. Dad cut himself too? Romilia asked. Somehow she wasn't surprised. He did not. He subjected himself to a more debasing treatment. That, I shall leave to him. Magnus cocked his head back, remembering. He revealed in pain. He loved it. It was a focus. It was a tool. It was a reward. It was a punishment and a blessing. He found his strength in it. He peered down at his niece. Then you were born. Tell me. Do you know why he wants you to stop feeling this pain when he felt it himself, and enjoyed it, for 3.5 millennia? Because he never looked in the mirror while he did it? Romilia asked. Magnus smiled. You are wise, child. Romilia shrugged, still feeling a creeping horror in her stomach. Your father came to view hurting oneself as indicative of a lack of strength, not a sign of strength. Do you share this belief? You came here, yes? I asked Miranda for help. She said I should let you do whatever it is that you do, Romilia confessed. So, I guess so. Magnus smiled again, all truculence gone. Dear child. If your father and you are correct, you should leave. Romilia blinked. What? If you had no strength, or not enough, you wouldn't have come here. I can't stop myself, Romilia said. The dread in her stomach pulled itself higher, tightening her throat again. Yes, you can. But you don't want to. At some level. Magnus softened the barb with a caveat. At least, that is what I would have said. If I agreed with your own conclusion. There is strength left in you, child. There is. Would you find it? Even if that means you have even less of a means of dealing with the pain, of whatever incident robs you of your stability? Romilia stared straight back at her uncle, terrified. His voice promised some horrible trials, she was sure, some grilling or test that would scour the weakness from her, but suddenly, she didn't care.
She couldn't even look her mother in the eye at dinner now. Her cousins were confronting her in front of her friends and family. Enough was enough. Yes. Magnus smiled once more. Good. Tell me, he asked, drawing a small blue card from his robes of office. Have you ever seen one of these before? Romilia leaned closer. Not sure. What is it? Here, Magnus said, passing her the object. Romilia held it up, staring at it. It's a business card, her voice choked off as she blacked out, sinking down onto the table with a thunk. Magnus took back the unoffending card, resting his hand on the back of her neck. Rest, child. The hardest part, for you, is over. Now, my work begins. Magnus effortlessly lifted the girl and laid her down on the table, glad she had chosen a modest outfit for the occasion. He, of course, had seen more intimately into the souls of men and women than mere eyes ever could, but he was certain he'd never hear the end of it if her blouse had fallen open in the middle of the process. Once she was down, and snoozing peacefully, Magnus glanced over her arms. Such pain you inflict upon yourself, girl. You should have sought help years ago. Rogel, you are a fool. Shaking his head again, he rested her hands over her heart, and sat down at the table side. Now, let us see how deep your scars lie, Romilia. He leaned forward, casting a small part of his mind across the insignificant gulf between him and the girl. She was a restful light blue, at the moment. Her mind was blank of dreams and thoughts, and in the absolute peace of her rest, was the absolute honesty of her spirit. It could not lie to Magnus. Poor thing, he whispered. Her soul was not the brilliant, undimmed beacon of his daughter. The sheer brilliance of her light drew a tear to his eye when she wasn't looking, out of paternal pride. Nor was it the endless complexity of Magnus' brother Horus, nor the swell of selfless kindness of Venus or the life-loving energy of Freya, but instead a darker pull. It frayed, it wore. And in it he sensed the same resignation and lack of motivation that plagued Furia, that which had only begun to heal after she had come so terribly close to loss. As he examined it, he was struck by its similarity to Alpharius' daughters. They, too, felt a lack of direction in their lives, exacerbated by a sense of inadequacy. They, at least, knew their feelings for the weakness it was, and attempted to overcome it. Romilia, he realized, hadn't had the guidance that the twins had had, each other. She was alone. Badly, deeply, painfully, alone. That, he could not cure. He set his mind's eye on the glowing crevasse in her psyche. There. It was from there that her pain stemmed. The slashes across her self-esteem and the frayed edges of her kindness, they stemmed from there. He closed his eye, allowing more of his untrammeled warp mastery pour loose, bathing her soul in light. Oh, Rogel, he said bitterly. You selfish bastard. The crack in her mind was more than loneliness. She did not solely feel alone. She felt incomplete. She saw in herself the design the Emperor had imparted, her genes twisted for great beauty, wisdom, longevity, health, but not success. She saw the wondrous Imperial Palace, the gleaming ranks of the Imperial Fists on parade, and she despaired of ever equaling her glorious father. Have you ever even told the girl how deeply you love her, you arrogant craven? Magnus hissed. Her memories parted before his psychic wake. He saw his brother lift the young Romilia over his head on Remembrance Day, rest her on his shoulders as a parade went by, hold her hand and look encouraging as a boyfriend walked out on her, but he saw also the look of stone on Rogel's face as Romilia scrambled through her bag for a report card, forgotten in a desk at school. He saw Dawn's cold face of disapproval as Romilia sobbingly hid her injured arm from her weeping mother. He saw. You son of a bitch, Magnus snarled under his breath. He saw her vision turn white from the blow as Dawn slapped his daughter across the face for daring to lift some trophy weapon from its cradle in the hall. No wonder the girl bleeds from the wrists, you churl, Magnus said darkly. You made her bleed from the lips. He pulled back, looking carefully at the rest of her memory. Her sports career. Her glee as she found her first puppy love, and her pride as she beat out even his own daughter Miranda at some academic achievement or another. Nowhere else in her entire mind did he see the pain and fear and loathing of that slap. I wonder, he said to himself. With exquisite care, he pulled her remembered memories aside, looking for something buried more deeply. With a glance at her body on the table, she slept still. He leaned into her mind, seeking the places where the character of her soul filtered through the sheen of her mind. "I see," he whispered. He had feared that she simply felt that she would never equal her father, but she saw instead a competition. She would never lead armies and legions, and she knew it. Instead, she would surpass his outward advancements. She sought to overcome every obstacle in her way, not because it was there, like he would, but because he would have done it. And when she hit a wall, some problem her competitive spirit could not surmount. "Then you take your own blood, sweet girl, in punishment," Magnus said. He opened his eye, staring at her prone form on the table. Her cheeks were caked in tears. They had not been there when he started. "You care for Morticia as much as Kali does. I dare say you care for her nearly as much as Brother Mortarion, who sees his wife as much as he sees his daughter, in her." Magnus carefully dried her cheeks, sighing to himself. "I shall see what I can do." He sat back down, focusing on the memory from which all the pain stemmed. "I will not take this from you, child. It is not mine to take. But, you deserve better than this." His mind sharpened, focusing his efforts. With the greatest care, he tamped the ragged edges of her conscience, her compassion. As he did, he saw her father, offering up a smile of approval as Romilia bounced a goal off the bar, sliding under the gully's hands. He saw both of her parents, hands held, as they watched Romilia accept the Junior Combined Activities Award, on stage, with rivals and friends alike applauding. "You do love her, Rogel. You just can't bring yourself to show it sometimes," Magnus said, his displeasure fading. "You and I must speak, when this is over." Romilia stirred. She blinked grime from her eyes, wiping her hand over them, and looked around herself. Magnus was sitting in the corner, cradling a vox in his hands. "Uncle Magnus?" "Romilia." Magnus looked up, exhausted, but clearly happy. "You awaken. Is it over? Am I still damned?" Romilia asked tremulously. "No, child, and I was very glad to see the worst had not come to pass. There was more strength in you than either of us guessed," Magnus admitted. "I owe you a sincere apology. The last soul from which I removed such a taint was beyond salvation. Yours is very much on the right path." Romilia recoiled, betrayal and relief battling for supremacy. "I was scared over nothing?" she asked. "Far from it," Magnus said gravely. "Your soul was in very real danger. But, do you feel different?" "No," she said. "I feel the same." "I see." Magnus stood. He dropped the vox into a charger, looking down at Romilia as she rolled off the table. "Give it a few days. Go see Morticia. You'll feel like a new woman." "Okay, who are you calling?" she asked in sudden suspicion. "Your father. You and he are going to have a very important conversation when you get home." "What did you tell him?" Romilia asked. "That strength comes from action as much as will," Magnus said darkly. Romilia shook her head, uncomprehending. "Fear not, you will see. Go, my child. And please, be well." "Thank you, Uncle Magnus," Romilia said. Litigation. Arthur Hayne wheeled a metal cart through the hall of the courtroom, parking it behind his desk at the front of the room. His counterpart, Keita's lawyer, Felga, was pushing a similar cart over behind his own desk. They exchanged a quick nod before the door swung open and admitted a third party. Fourth Provost Marshal Rackness marched up the center aisle, stopping before the bench, staring impassively up at its occupant. Third Provost Marshal Mako stood, gesturing all to rise. Both lawyers and the lesser judge stood respectfully. "Gentlemen, I understand I've been called upon to mediate a dispute in the case of the Imperium v. Ulysses Keita," Mako said. The bailiff gestured for the three men to sit. The lawyers did, but Rancius stood, hands at his side. Mako lifted the data slit in front of her, reading down the motion. "Counselor Felga, why have you seen fit to ask for the dismissal of 4th Provost Marshal Rackness in this case?" Comments that his honor registered while I filed my motion to dismiss the case lead me to think that he had allowed himself a bias against my client, Felga said. He stood and carried a sheaf of paper to the bench, passing it up to the judge. Mako did not remove her helmet except in bench cases, but here she did, and she examined the paper Felga had given her with her own eyes. Counselor, your claim seems to hinge on Judge Rackness having a desire to convict your client before the evidence had been presented, Mako said. That is correct, Felga said. Counselor, nearly everyone on the planet has heard of this case. If you're trying to find a way to prove that Judge Rackness went into the meeting with too much knowledge of the case, you are out of luck. Mako lowered the papers, gauging Felga from her high vantage. Not too much knowledge, Your Honor. A desire for a certain outcome. I direct your attention to line 42, Felga said. Mako looked down the sheet to the words in question. Counselor Felga, your client was attempting a change of the status quo of the Imperium through killing someone, Mako recited. That sounds to me like he was assuming an outcome to the charge before the trial began, Your Honor, Felga said. Haynes' jaw tightened. Rackner stared at his superior, expressionless. Mako read the entire transcript, beginning to end, then folded it on the table, sat back with her fingers steepled, and thought carefully. It seems that Counselor Felga may have a point, Judge Rackness. Have you anything to say in rebuttal? Rackness steeled himself. I do not, Judge Mako. And I respectfully tender my withdrawal from this case. I cannot allow even the appearance of bias to color such a vital proceeding. Haynes stared. Mako nodded slowly. I accept your request, Judge Rackness. As the position of 4th Provost Marshal is an exclusive one, I shall be handling the case myself. Very well, thank you, Judge, Felga said, nodding his assent. Haynes risked a glance at Rackness again. Rackness looked more resigned than angry. Haynes interpreted that as a good sign. Freya tried not to break the vox in her hands. What does that mean? She asked, keeping her voice level. It means nothing. Truly. Mako is one of the most level-headed, rational judges in the Arbites, her father answered. Trust me, she will side with Hayne. I sure hope so, Freya said quietly. Lemon went quiet. Don't worry. Keita can't win this. How is your project going? He asked, diverting to what he hoped was safer grounds. Awful, Freya moped. The presentation is fine, but the paper is crap. What's wrong with it? I just reread it, and I don't quite meet the citation standards, she complained. I had to go rewrite a bunch of it. That sucks, Lemon said, glancing out the viewport to his left. He was standing on the launch platform for lightning fighters on the lunar platform on which his meeting was being held. Do they let people watch? No, just the moderator, Freya glumly reported. She blew a strand of red out of her eyes. Otherwise I would totally let you come intimidate them. That's I'm for, Lemon said sarcastically. I'll hear all about it when I get home, okay? Sure thing, Dad, she said wistfully. See you tomorrow. She clicked the vox off, dropping it in the cradle. Alex tapped his stylus on the papers in front of them, lost in the work. What did he say? He said not to worry about it, Freya said, dropping back into her seat. Any luck? The principles of higher calculus continue to elude me, Alex reported. Freya huffed. All right. Is it answers in the back time? It may very well be, Alex said heavily, turning to the back and poring over it. Romilia stood patiently at the door of her father's study, waiting for him. Dawn stared at the news ticker at the bottom of his monitor rack to catch up, grimacing in displeasure. They went with a different judge. What the hell is Keita up to? He snarled under his breath. He spotted his daughter at the corner of the room and switched the monitors off, beckoning her in. Romilia, welcome home. Father, she said formally. Dawn sagged in his throne, suddenly seeming much older. I had a chat with your uncle Magnus, you know. I was there, Romilia pointed out. Dawn closed his eyes, fighting down his anger. Yes. So I've been told. Romilia. Why didn't you just, he clenched his fists under the table. Why didn't you just ask me? Ask you what, Dad?
Romilia shot back. Ask you why you slapped the shit out of me? No. Why did you need Magnus to pick over your brain when all it would have taken was a question to me? Dawn riposted. I would have told you. Then why didn't you? She roared, civility completely gone. What could possess you to think that was a good idea? Do not speak to me of possession, my daughter. Not for one second, Dawn said darkly. Stop dancing. She barked. I went to Magnus because I was powerless. Because I couldn't stop turning my life into a competition. And then, hey. Surprise, surprise. You did it too. And then, Magnus tells me you changed your tune when I was born. Did you get a revelation you'd like to share? Romilia's cheeks were beet red, tears pooling in both eyes. What did you learn, Dad? What secrets did you stumble upon that made it all worthwhile? Tell me. Damn it, I want to know. She said, loathing and regret cracking her voice. Dawn clenched the edge of the table. Very hard. Romilia, he ground out. I realized that it took more than tolerance for pain to grow stronger. He tore his eyes off the desk to stare into his daughter's red-rimmed gaze. I wanted you to arrive at the same conclusion. Why? She asked bitterly, tears pouring down her face now, her voice barely more than a whisper. Why didn't you just tell me? Because some lessons can't be passed along, Dawn rumbled. Some have to be learned. Is that why you hit me? Romilia choked out. Dawn closed his eyes again, pinching the bridge of his nose. It may be meaningless to say so. But I have regretted that since it happened. Odd way to show it, Romilia snarled, a little fire creeping back into her voice. Dawn's eyes snapped open, and he shot the glare straight back. I have never once handed you the knife, Romilia. I've never once carved a line through your flesh. You did that. Not me, not some memory of me, not some instruction or failure. You. It was a conscious choice, every time. The same as when I did it to myself. Small words, Dad, small words, Romilia said, though she couldn't deny them either. When did you offer to help? Some lessons are meant to be learned on their own. Dawn repeated. Some. She suddenly screamed. Not all. She grabbed the hem of her long-sleeved shirt and ripped it off over her head, exposing the tracery of scar on her arms. When did you plan on giving me advice? Or a little guidance? Or even asking me why I did it? When did you realize you couldn't justify it? Dawn asked coldly. When did you realize you weren't interested in stopping it? Romilia asked, lava and ice mingling in her voice in equal measure. Dawn shot to his feet. Would I have told you to stop if I didn't want you to? God knows you weren't trying very hard, Romilia hissed. Something made you stop hurting yourself after 3.5 millennia. What was it, and why couldn't you share it with me? I already told you. I realized that I was gaining nothing, Dawn said, staring his daughter down. Would it have killed you to tell me? Clearly you didn't figure it out in time. Don't know why you expected me to. And we both know that you're not happy unless I'm not quite measuring up to you, Romilia said, glaring at him. Dawn recoiled. I have never said that. Ever. Romilia started a rejoinder, but Dawn cut her off. No, damn it, we have this out now. I have never, even once, said that you had to match up to me for me to be happy, or even the reverse. Never. There's a lot you don't say, Dad, and sometimes I don't catch it, Romilia said, loathing, for herself and her father, dripping from her voice. Romilia. But sometimes I get enough. I can't lead an army or design the palace or break an orc in half, but I can read between the lines well enough, she said, neatly ignoring her own argument for how her father should have told her to stop and explain why outright. When have you ever actually helped me accomplish anything? When have I struck an obstacle, and had you there to help me over it? I am proud of you every single time you accomplish a goal alone, Dawn said. But I shouldn't have to do it alone, Romilia said angrily. She drew herself up to her full height, and slapped a hand across her heart, clenching her hand in the sports bra's strap. If you see me struggle with something, no matter what it is, and you've overcome it yourself, you have no reason not to help me. Not do it for me, she said angrily,
cutting her father off. But help me. Is that so much to ask, damn it? Dawn stared at her, his own anger boiling under the surface. I am not a good father, Remilia. I didn't need Magnus to tell me that. But I have looked to make you stronger the same way I made myself and my legion stronger. I showed you what it was to overcome an obstacle. I showed you how to find power in a challenge. No. No, Dad. You're not a bad father because you showed me all that shit. You're a bad father because you left me to figure it out by myself, and never told me when I got the answer wrong, Remilia said, her exhaustion and anger burning a hole in her emotions, until all that was left in her voice was emptiness. I'm not one of your soldiers, Dad. I'm not a space marine. I'm a 17-year-old girl. I have one cousin on the edge of a drug addiction, one in the hospital for a gunshot wound, and one whose mind is falling apart. And when you see me hurting, and see me wanting the pain to stop, your approach is to berate me. I don't care how much pride you find in me getting shit done. That one reaction is all I need to know about what you think fathering is about. Remilia's eyes were flattened, her voice dead and cold. She shrugged her shirt back on in silence. I think I need to go see somebody. I don't know who. I have my Vox. Call me sometime, tomorrow maybe. I need to get shit figured out. She turned on her heel and walked out, her knees weak. She wandered down the halls of the manor, scooping random detritus from her room into a bag and throwing it over her shoulder. She dropped her copy of the graduation paper in the bag, too. It was her day tomorrow, after all. Couldn't forget it. Tears stung her eyes, and she blinked, trying to push them back. She grabbed her Vox, switched it on. With a final once over of her room, she grabbed her datislet and slung it on its strap. She walked down to the drive, bags and sling in hands. She knew her father would be watching from his study, but she didn't turn around. Let him stew. Let him rot, in fact. She didn't care. Not yet. She walked up to the family limousine, opening the rear door. The driver, an elderly Legion serf, huffed up to it as she got in. I do apologize, Madam Dawn. I didn't see you come out. Would you like me to take you somewhere? Please. Sorry I crept up on you, this isn't scheduled. Indeed not, madam, it is no trouble at all. Where shall I take? Oh dear, he said, noting the state of her. Madam, are you all right? By no means, Remilia said hollowly. Is there anything I can do? The chauffeur asked worriedly. Nope, but you would if you could. I've learned how much that means. She turned her tear-streaked face up to him and managed a tiny, completely empty smile. But yes. Right now I need to be somewhere else. Your father will ask me where I've taken you, he said, sitting down behind the controls. Tell him. It's not a secret, she said as the vehicle started up and hovered over the ground. Back to Lord Magnus Manor, madam? The man asked. No, 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 Remilia said hastily. Sorry, somewhere else. She said, quickly thinking it over. Lord Russ Place. Please. Straight away, madam, the driver said, entering the course. An outside perspective. Freya sat at a table, tears gathering in her eyes as her cousin relayed the entire story. The soul healing, the argument, the cutting and when it had started, all of it. Oh my god, Remilia, come here. She said, the tears breaking free. She stood up and stepped to her cousin's side, crouching beside her chair and wrapping her in a crushing bear hug. Tea thanks, Freya, Remilia managed. Her own tears stained Freya's skin-tight denim top, but she hurriedly broke the hug. I need to tell someone. Hell yes you do, Freya said, wiping her own tears away. God, Remilia, the pain you're in. Right now it doesn't hurt. Remilia said brokenly. Right now I'm just tired. Yeah, I bet. Freya wiped her eyes again, sitting down. Alex was waiting awkwardly in Freya's room, still, where he had been since his woman's cousin had shown up at the door in tears. Freya thought hurriedly, wondering if the schedule for the night was still set in stone. Listen, I didn't want to interrupt, but I know a few of the others are already going to come over tonight.
Is that okay? You can sleep in the guest wing. You don't have to talk to them. It's your house, Freya, Romilia said. I can't be home right now. You can stay as long as you want, Freya promised. The doorbell rang, and she hurriedly looked at her blonde cousin. Romilia sniffled, then looked up at Freya and nodded. Okay, I'll be in the guest wing if you need me, she said, grabbing her bags and walking off. About 1 hour later, she was sitting in the chair in the guest suite she had picked, watching the fields outside sway in the moonlight. Her eyes weren't as sharp as Freya's, of course, or even as sharp as Isis or Cora's, but they were still a genetic marvel. She watched the tiny movements of grass as animals ran by at the base of the stalk, and envied them. Their lives were simpler. A quiet knock on the door brought her out of her reverie. She checked to make sure she was still dressed, and cracked it open. A space wolf serf stood there with a tray of something that smelled really good. My Lady Dawn. Compliments of Lady Russ, the serf said, placing it on the table by the door. Romilia nodded. Thank Gerwin for me, then, would you? She asked, lifting the lid on the little pot. Lady Gerwin is on Luna, Lady Dawn. I meant it was Lady Freya, the serf corrected. And I shall pass it along, he bowed out, closing the door behind him. Romilia sniffed the fragrant liquid in the tiny silver pot. Oh. Onion broth. Good call, Freya. She put the lid back on, smiling despite herself. I'm never calling you Furball again, she promised. She sat down by the table and dug in, mopping the soup up with some crackers. Just as she finished, another knock came from the door. Romilia quickly wiped down her mouth with a napkin. Come in, she said. The door swung open. This time, though, her visitor was no servant. Romilia, Venus started, her eyes dim and drawn. Talk to me. Venus, Romilia said, surprised. Didn't know you were coming over tonight. Sure. I had to. Finals and presentations all this week, remember? Freya wouldn't let that happen without observing the ritual, Venus pointed out, sitting down at the table. Romilia blinked. Ritual? What ritual? Oh, yeah, you're not in on it yet, Venus said, suddenly bashful. Well, I imagine she let you in on it if you ask nice. What is this ritual? Romilia asked, completely confused. Well, whenever we have a big test coming up, a bunch of us get together here before it happens and we all swap boyfriends. It's so incredibly helpful. Haven't you seen how much Freya's grades have gone up since she met Alex? Romilia stared at her cousin in absolute shock, until a hint of suspicion crossed her face. Wait. Wait, are you fucking with me? You're fucking with me, aren't you? Yes, Venus said, nodding slowly. Yes, I am fucking with you. Oh, fucking hell, Romilia scoffed. I had you. Hook, line, and sinker. You believed every single word, Venus said, smiling. That's a problem, too. You usually see through my terrible lies. I'm in a bit of a rut right now, Romilia admitted. Yeah, Freya didn't tell me anything, but she's also really bad at hiding things. I could tell you were here, Venus said sadly. She reached over and squeezed her cousin's hands, catching them between her own. She trained her eyes on Romilia's, and they were a far dimmer red tonight. But I'm a hopeless softy. I need to try to make you feel better. So come on out of here and be with us for a while, okay? Ah, I would, but I need to work on the paper too, Romilia said, scrambling for an excuse. No, you finished yesterday, Venus pointed out. And you did the speech too. All rehearsed. How did you know? Romilia asked in surprise. I know you, Romilia. That's why you need to be with us, tonight. Venus stood, pulling Romilia's hands with hers. The blonde soccer player, however, stayed in her seat, her eyes betraying her torment. Venus looked at her for a few moments longer, before letting her cousin's hands fall through her own. All right. I understand. She turned to leave, walking back through the open door, closing it behind her. Romilia sat at the table, staring at the empty dishes in silence, fuming, until she leaped from her seat and jogged after her cousin. Wait,
Wait, she called after her. You're right. Yep, Venus said contentedly. She waited in the hall for her cousin to catch up, offering an encouraging little smile to her cousin. Ready? Yeah, Romilia breathed. Lead the way. So, I look at the guy on the stage asking the questions, and I realize he's quoting the interview section of the book I read to source my argument, Jake explained. Alex tilted his head back and laughed raucously. Fucking serious, man? He was quoting it? Yep. It was a test. He wanted to see if I had actually read it or not, Jake said. So I started giving the specific answers from the book back to him. He nodded. So I assume I passed. Alex tilted his glass to him. Nice. He turned to see Romilia emerge from the side corridor with Venus. Hey, there she is. You feeling better? A little, yeah. Thanks for the snack, Freya, Romilia said. She turned to Jake, forcing a smile on her face. What was your topic? Support structures for the mentally disabled in private schools, Jake said. Aside from the one bit where the interviewer started quoting my sources to see how closely I had been reading them, it was rough. I couldn't really do a visual, so I just made these little paper handouts in envelopes. Seemed to work. Good. I bet you did great, Romilia said. She took a discreet head count as she listened. Jake, Venus, Alex, Freya, herself, Faith, and Pietro. Good. No sickers. She may have been doing a poor job of hiding her feelings, but at least there were no mind readers in the crowd. Anyone else go yet? Me, Pietro said. The core systems and their means of economic stabilization of the expansion zones. Right single quotation mark. Me too, Faith said. The balance of Mechanicus doctrine with post-educational requirements. Right single quotation mark. Freya nodded glumly. I think I need to put a bit more work into mine. Plus that math test Thursday. Blug. Yeah, that's a mean one, Pietro said ruefully. I can help you study for it if you need me to, Jake offered. Math is my best subject, after chemistry. No, thanks. I think I can handle it, Pietro said, downing his tea. The little group sat there, discussing the few parts of their lives that could be called normal, until Romilia felt her bone weariness set in. Sorry to break it up, guys, but I'm really tired. I think I'm going to turn in. Okay, Freya said sadly. Feel better tomorrow? I hope so, Romilia said. She stood, turning to the hall, but lingered a moment, catching Jake's eye. He stood, curious, and followed her down the hallway to the guest suite. The luxurious room didn't look a thing like the decor in the rest of the house, with its rough simplicity. Everything here was more ornate, designed to look old-fashioned. Romilia pushed the door open, then nearly collapsed into the chair next to the door. Jake paused at the threshold, somewhat nervous. Did you want something? He asked. Please sit down, Romilia said quietly. I want to ask you something. Jake did so. The surf had been back to clear away the detritus of her snack, Romilia noted distantly. Jake, I've never seen Venus happier. I hate to burden you like this, but can you help me figure some shit out? If I can help, I will, Jake promised. Okay. Can you keep a secret? Sure I can, Jake said, a bit nervously. What is it? Jake, I'm really, really scared. I have the best sisters I could ever want, but I can't, she struggled to find words. I can't, I'm afraid of my father. I'm afraid of him now. It only started a few hours ago, but it's there. Romilia, I've never even met Lord Dawn, Jake pointed out, feeling like the ground was falling out from under him. I know, Jake, but I, Romilia clamped her mouth shut, thinking furiously. I'm sorry. I can't ask this without sounding like a horrible person. But, how do hivers deal with this kind of shit? Family trouble? You have so few places to go. Jake nodded slowly, thinking her words over. I don't know where to start, Romilia. My family, we've always lived in the hives. Even my grandfather, who was one of the greatest magi of his temple, always lived in the hives when he could.
We're spread out all over the hab, it's true, but we always have each other. Of course, Romilia said in a small, contrite voice. I'm sorry. Like I said, horrible. Romilia, don't beat yourself up. I didn't know how surfaces lived before I went to Imperator. I don't expect you to know how hivers live. Jake leaned forward, trying to sound more helpful than patronizing. I thought you people lived in apartments made of gold. Well, no, not exactly, but the thought was the same. And in the time since I've come up here, I've wanted to strangle a few of our classmates for wasting as much as they do. I don't know if that sense of waste and entitlement extends to the actual nobility themselves, in their lives and families, but the others at school sure have it. Now, I've never met your father. From what I've heard, he is a scary son of a bitch and a powerful leader of men. But, from the sound of it, the two of you had it out today. You could say that, Romilia muttered. What does wasteful living have to do with anything? Because, Romilia, I don't know if the troubles you're having stem from the natural filter of disposability through which the people up here see everything, or if you're having a problem I can address, Jake said bluntly. Romilia jerked her head up, stung. I don't think of things as disposable. This table is worth more than 4 months' pay in my weekend job, Jake pointed out. That necklace Venus made, the one she's wearing tonight. I could buy the apartment my neighbors live in for a month with it. Having something and wasting it are two different things, Romilia argued. And we're getting off topic. Yeah, all right. Jake sat back, working through his own nervousness. Sorry, I didn't mean to go on a tangent. But I know some guys at school who got into pretty dumb fights with their parents over shit a hiver would shrug off. This is a little more serious, I bet, Romilia said. Romilia, I gotta say, I don't know how much of a help I can be if your father frightens you. From what I know of you, from what we've said to each other since we met, I think you're a pretty strong girl. I don't know what you said to him, and what he said to you, to make you so scared. So what is it? Jake asked reasonably. He told me that he was a bad father, and I agreed, Romilia said, letting it tumble out. I hurt myself, and he did it when he was younger too, and rather than help me stop, he just yelled at me and didn't say anything that would help. Okay, Jake said. Whoa. Yeah, it wasn't fair of me to ask you to help me, was it? Romilia said miserably. She stood up from the chair, tottered over to the bed, and collapsed, face down in the cover. Sorry. You can go. Jake stared at her for a moment, before standing and closing the door. He sat down next to her on the bed, his mind racing. Romilia, all I can tell you is what I would do if I were having a problem with my own father. And we've had a few fights, believe me. Her voice was muffled by the covers. Yeah? She asked. Like what? Well, when he found out I was dating Venus, he asked me to stop. He thought I would embarrass her family, Jake said truthfully. Romilia popped her head up to look at him. Really? What did you say? If you say so, Dad, Jake recalled. Then I went ahead and dated her anyway. Whoa. Was he pissed off? Livid, Jake said. I didn't care. Then I brought Venus home one day, and she got to meet him. And of course they hit it off just fine. I think Dad made the same mistake that a lot of hivers make. They think of you and your family like demigods or something. Yeah. One of them took it so far that he shot someone who wasn't in perfect accord with Grandpa, or tried, Romilia said darkly. I really, sincerely hope you're not comparing George Seeger to Ulysses Keeter, Jake said. Fuck, no, of course not, Romilia said hastily. I didn't, damn it. She said, slamming a fist into the bedspread. Jake sighed. The next big one was when the Treasury got involved with us, Jake continued. The Emperor had put us on the VIP list, since he had misinterpreted my name being on the special guests list for the museum wing opening party at the palace. When I came home, Dad was standing there in the main room, just waiting to grill me. Know what I did? What? I called Venus on my Vox, but pretended that Vulcan had picked up. Yes, Lord Vulcan, I can ask. By the way, I didn't make too much noise with your daughter last night, did I? He pantomimed. Romilia actually giggled. You didn't. I did. Did I exacerbate her back too much? I certainly wasn't trying to. Come to think of it, I still don't know if Dad's figured out that it was Venus at the other end. Haha, that's great. Romilia crossed her arms under her chest and smiled up at Jake. So, aside from trolling and ignoring him, how do you deal with problems? I talk it out. I try to remember that he's been through some shit in his time too, Jake said. I don't know if he'd want me to tell you this, but when he was 17, he was arrested for possession. Whoa. Yeah. He got off, but it was close. Arbites wanted to make an example out of him. So I remember that he's got reasons to telling me to do or not to do shit. Yeah. I guess I just want Dad to tell me when he has some reason for the bullshit he pulls, Romilia said angrily. Well, assume that he has one. He's not stupid. But ask when he doesn't tell you outright. That's about what I can provide. All right. Romilia went quiet, staring at her arms. I did have one more question. Two, actually. Sure. Please don't answer this if it makes you uncomfortable, all right? She asked, looking sidelong up at him. When he nodded, she continued. Do you and Venus ever fight? Jake hesitated. Never about anything meaningful. I mean, once or twice, yeah, but not something we'd break up over. Like what? Romilia asked. Sorry to be nosy. Jake thought for a moment, looking off into the distance. I'm not really comfortable answering that in detail. But, I guess there's one thing. When we first met, I treated her differently from the other students at Imperator. I treated her like the other members of the royal family, like you and Farah. She acted really weird over that. I thought she was just like that always, but then Farah explained that she hated being treated differently from the other students at the school, royalty or not. Once we got that ironed out, things were okay. Well, don't answer more than that if you don't want to, Romilia said. Unless, did Venus already tell you about the party? Jake asked. Huh. You mean the party where she hurt her back? Yeah. Yeah, she said a little. She was discreet, but she and I chatted a bit that morning, on the net. Jake grimaced a little. See, now I don't want to make you uncomfortable. I was dumb enough to ask, Romilia said. I asked her why she would hurt herself like that. And, she told me that it was how the salamanders decorate themselves after a victory, or to commemorate something. Jake looked down at Romilia. Is it like that for your dad and you, too? Sort of, Romilia said, deciding to leave the lengthier story for later. Well, she promised me that she would never do anything like that again. I believe her. I think she understands that I think it's barbaric, and that her father doesn't want that to be part of her life. See, that gets me. Dad wants me to stop, so I do. But he wants me to stop for the worst possible reason. He cares more about me figuring out why I should stop than the fact that it was happening in the first place. Romilia exploded. I can't speak to that, Jake cautioned, but if he really didn't care about you, would he want you to stop at all? Since he thinks it made him stronger? I don't know. Maybe. He was the reason I was cutting in the first place, Romilia said bitterly. Really? How do you figure? Fuck, I don't know. I'm too tired for this shit, Romilia grumbled. I don't think he likes seeing me angry. I want to think he just can't understand why I'm so disappointed in him. Jake nodded sadly. Do you know why? Because he never once helps me figure things out. I'm always on my own. What about Lady Dawn? Mom's never around. She's always off championing some charitable cause or other. Never here when I need her. Romilia sighed heavily, her shoulders shifting under the weight of the world. I should apologize to Miranda and Magnus for dragging them into this. She looked up to see Jake looking down at her, clearly pained. I guess, I'm just angry at how little it means to him that I be a part of his life. The pale Hiver didn't say a word, just looked down at the princess in silence. She held his gaze for a few seconds, before her eyes unfocused.
Faith is completely full of shit. But she's right sometimes. She once told me revelation doesn't heal. Jake reached over and grabbed her closer hand, running his fingers along hers. Do you want me to stay here for a while longer, or should I go? He asked. Romilia felt her pulse quicken a bit before shaking off her irrational impulse. I should sleep, she said. All right, Jake said, offering up one last smile. See you after the presentation tomorrow. Yep, she said faintly. Jake stood up to go, reaching for the handle. Her voice caught him up short. Jake? Yes? Do you really think surfaces are wasteful? Do you want me to be honest, or nice? He asked hesitantly. Honest's worked so far, she pointed out. I think the cruelest thing the Emperor ever did was build a world where his chosen live in such splendor, and everyone else lives in such deprivation, Jake said truthfully. It took effort not to resent surfaces. Romilia thought for a moment. Is it wrong of me to want to do something nice for you for helping me get my shit together? No, but I won't accept anything too expensive. I'll feel bad. I'm full of contradictions like that, he joked. Okay. Romilia smiled into the downy cover. You have a nice shoulder. Can I lean on it again sometime? Jake chuckled. If you need one. Good. Say goodnight to everyone for me, okay? She asked. You bet. He turned the lights off with a wave. Sleep well. Venus and the others were waiting for him when he got back. Is she going to be alright? Freya worried. Jake smiled wearily. She'll be fine. She just needs about 3 days worth of sleep. What she needs is a hot dicking and a father that doesn't wish he had a son. Freya growled. Hey, Jake said, frowning at her. She's a mess. Just let her be. Can you get her to school tomorrow? She said she would want to visit Miranda's to thank Lord Magnus for his help after the presentation. I'll do it, Freya said. All right. Jake grabbed his jacket. Then, if you don't mind, I think I need to head out. Me too, Pietro said, fishing his keys out of his pocket. Thanks for having us over, Freya. Hey, anytime. The perky redhead watched the others file out and say their goodbyes, until she was alone in the room. A serf popped his head in from a side door. Freya, may I tidy up a bit? He asked. Yeah, sure, she said, standing up. We're done. Very well, the serf said, making for the pile of dishes in the middle of the sitting room. Freya stood up, brushing her knees free of crumbs. Romilia was pulling the covers up when yet another knock came from the door. Who's there? She asked blearily. Me, Freya called back. Can I come in? Okay, Romilia said, yanking the covers up a bit higher. Freya pushed the old-fashioned wood doors open and walked in, closing them behind her. Hey. I'm glad you got to talk with Jake. Yeah, Romilia said wearily. He's good people. He is. Freya didn't wave the lights up, her eyes could see through the darkness like there was a searchlight in each one. Are you going to be okay? Not for a few days, but eventually, I suspect so, Romilia said, letting her head fall back to the pillows. Do you want to know what my dad would say if he were here? Freya asked hesitantly. What? Romilia sighed. Your cousin needs a vacation, I think, Freya intoned. Ha. Huh. He's not wrong. After graduation, I think we should go on a tour. You, me, Venus, Alex, Jake. Just a few months. Go see the galaxy a little, Freya said. A road trip? Really? Yeah. Fenris, Nocturne. Venus really wants to go home, see it. I do too. I can't say I'm fucked to see Inuit, but a vacation sounds grand, Romilia said. Maybe I can guilt dad into loaning me the phalanx. Freya didn't answer for a moment, and Romilia huffed. It was a joke. Oh. I was really unsure for a moment. Freya padded silently over to where her sister lay, and gingerly leaned down next to her. I mean it. Stay a while. Get your head together. Thanks, Freya, Romilia said. Freya nipped her ear. Now go get some sleep yourself, okay? Presentations. Right. Freya straightened up.
Good night. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock, and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Passionate silence. Alex pulled his shorts down, admiring his physique in the mirror in the bathroom of Freya's suite. Glancing over his reflection, he finished his bathroom processes and thought over what Freya had said. A road trip? Really? To Fenris and to Nocturne? As much as it sounded awesome, he had his doubts. He knew Lemon Russ was slowly growing to like him, even if he was still openly uncomfortable around him. But would the other wolves tolerate some non-genomated human in their midst? The door to the bedroom swung open. He hurriedly cracked the door open, catching a glimpse of Freya's red hair in the bedroom. Hey. She okay? She's fine. She loved the idea of a trip, Freya answered, replacing him in the bathroom. Yeah? I'm a bit nervous, myself, Alex admitted. The door to the bathroom closed behind his girlfriend, cutting off his words. He slid into the bed, waving the lights down to total blackness. After a few minutes passed, he tensed up, waiting. He strained his ears, listening for any sign of her return. The door to the bathroom opened up, and he caught a hint of her outline in the darkness as she turned the lights off. He stretched his hearing out to its limits, trying to find her. Give up, she whispered from his side of the bed. You won't catch me until I let you. Unless I get lucky, he whispered back. You will only catch me if you're about to get lucky, she corrected him, crawling across him and snuggling under the covers. Well put. Alex wrapped an arm under her shoulders, pulling her in. To that end. Sorry. I can't enjoy myself with Romilia falling apart at the seams a few halls down, Freya said apologetically. She kissed him on the forehead. I'd feel bad for her. Or, the one night her father's nose isn't in the house and she doesn't wanna fuck. Alex leaned back against the headboard and snapped his fingers. The window creaked open, letting a little of the light and sound from the field outside filter into the room. Did you hear me when I said I was a bit off kilter about this whole trip thing? Yeah. Dad's old friends put the scare in you? She asked. Baby, your friends are 8-foot tall killing machines with serrated canines and mongoose reflexes. They scare the shit out of me. How are they gonna react when I stroll into the Fang hand in hand with you? Cat calls, challenges to drinking contests, pats on the back, and at least one semi-serious offer to induct you into the wolves. Then Dad will hold a feast to welcome himself back to the Fang, and we'll have a grand old time, while you draw the eyes and envy of every serf in the fortress, Freya predicted happily. You've thought about this, haven't you? Alex accused. Yep. You'll like them. You really will, Freya promised. HMMPH. If you say so, Alex said. Outside, Jake lifted his car off the ground and started out. Hey, you want to do something tonight? He asked. It's only 2,200. Venus thought it over, then shook her head. No thanks. Can we just head out? It's been pretty rough. That's what I mean, Jake said, keying in her address anyway. Something to take the edge off. Actually, Venus said, could we divert to your place instead? He shrugged. Works for me, Jake said, keying the pad. But won't the treasury get on your ass over it? Hey, not again, she said, waving off his concerns. The car soared over to the airlock, queuing up behind the usual evening traffic. Jake looked out at the row of seeker drones by the lock. The little machines weren't remote controlled, but they weren't completely autonomous either, he knew. They had set instructions to scan passing vehicles and divert their autopilots if need be. What they did to manually piloted craft, he didn't know. But then, who flew the airlock manually? Can I ask what you and Romilia talked about?
Venus asked, breaking into his thoughts. Jake grimaced, wondering how private she was asking her to be. She really confided in me. I was surprised. She wanted a hiver's perspective. Right single quotation mark. Venus gaped. Are you serious? She asked. That's so rude. Yeah, but I can't get mad at her. She wanted to know how hivers settle family disputes. I couldn't really find a polite way to tell her that we're a fairly complex group and can't really be shoehorned into one group like that, so I just let it slide. Well, I'm sorry she put you on the spot like that, Venus said. Don't be. It's not your fault. And I didn't mind answering her other questions. She wanted to know if I ever argued with my father, or with you. What did you tell her? Venus asked. She wasn't judging. She just wanted to know. Nothing too intimate. I think she just wants someone to talk to. Frankly, I think she needs a guy, Jake said, as the car slid through the lock. Venus made a non-committal sound, thinking about what he had said. Do you like Freya's road trip idea? I think it's awesome. I can't wait, Jake said, grinning from ear to ear. I've always wanted to go into space. I've been to Mars a few times, but I've never left the solar core, Venus said, using the technical term for all bodies within the Jovian orbit. Went to the experimental yeast plant on Mercury with Dad when I was 4. So boring. Had to stay inside the radiation shield the whole time. Probably wise, Jake noted. The car swooped over the token Praetor vehicle under the lock, flying for the apartment. I'm really looking forward to this, he continued. You've told me a lot about Nocturne, but what is Fenris like? Freya never talks about it. It's a glacier world. Mostly. Some jungle at the equator, I think, Venus said. The wolves rule over it as tribal gods. The hardiest tribal warriors' children join the wolves as inductees and go through training like the rest of the legions. Or did you mean the culture? Well, if it's a tribal world, there won't be too much technology, will there? Jake reasoned. We won't be going outside much, trust me, Venus promised. Predators on Fenris can grow the size of acres. And those other birds. Awesome, Jake said happily. When do we leave? Heh. It'll be a while. I think my parents are going to want to hold a get-together after the ceremony. Graduation party, you know. And I will definitely need to find a ship to carry us, she went on. I want this to be somewhat low-key. Maybe a salamander ship. Hadn't thought of that, he admitted. Do you have your own ship? Venus shook her head. No, even we aren't allowed our own ships. We'd be diverting navigators from the merchant fleets for nothing. The car coasted to a halt in the lot outside his hab structure. As they climbed out, Jake discreetly palmed a little plastic box under his seat and slid it into his pocket before locking the car and following Venus out. His parents were sitting in the eating nook, chatting over the remains of a late dinner, when they spotted their son and his girlfriend. Hey, you two, George called out, brushing his hands off and standing up, as he always did by instinct when he saw Venus. How was it? Horrible, Venus said heavily. What was wrong? Sandra asked in surprise. Venus glanced at Jake for support before continuing. Romilia's having a lot of trouble at home. Oh, that's a shame, Sandra said, standing too. Is she going to be alright? Eventually, I hope. Venus glanced at Jake again, this time in mischief. I think the road trip will help. Road trip? George asked. Yep. She, Freya, and I are going on vacation after graduation, Venus announced. And I'm going with them, Jake said proudly. George blinked. You are? Yes. Me and Alex are going with, Jake explained. 3 months or so, from graduation to just before school starts up again. Well, that sounds like a lot of fun, Sandra said. Where are you going? Venus's smile took on a sly grin. I'm going home. Nocturne? George asked, stunned. You're going to Nocturne? Yep, she declared happily. I've wanted to try going into space since I was a kid, Jake said excitedly. We're going to go do Nocturne and Fenris,
for about a month each, with the rest of the time in travel. His father nodded. Whoa. Well, good on you, Jake. That sounds awesome, George admitted. How long before you head out?
Right after graduation party season, Venus said cheerfully, and I need to actually book us a ship. Nocturne and Fenris are both technically death worlds, so no passage on civilian ships, but I'm sure Dad or Horus can whip up a reason for us to go. Will you be bringing Morticia with you?
I'm sure she'd love to get out of the hospital for a while, Sandra pointed out. Venus's eyes froze. Clearly she hadn't thought of that.
I bet she would, bitter. Her homeworld's atmosphere is very, very toxic, and B, she may not be ready to go in 3 weeks.
Shame. George smiled proudly. Still, I'm sure it'll be a grand time.
Have you ever been to space?
Venus asked the both of them.
I've been to Mars 8 or 9 times, George said.
Sandra shook her head.
Never.
Well, I've never been outside the core, Venus said.
Hum. Should be fun.
Send pictures?
Sandra asked teasingly.
Mom, we don't leave for 3 weeks, Jake laughed.
The four of them sat back down at the table, discussing the logistics of the expedition, until George looked at his watch and realized the time.
Well, some of us have work tomorrow, so I think we need to turn in.
All right, then, see you both tomorrow, Jake said, standing too.
You're heading somewhere?
Sandra asked.
Jake stared.
No. Just, saying goodnight.
Oh. All right, good night then.
See you later, Venus. Sandra said, making for the tiny bathroom.
Bathroom tasks accomplished, both Elder Seekers retired, leaving Jake and Venus alone.
Jake let the nervous grin he had been holding the entire time out, reaching across the table and grabbing her hand. He lifted it up to his lips, as much out of romance as to hide the goofy look.
Stay with me tonight? He asked softly.
Venus bit her own lip, casting a stare at the closed door to the master bed.
Can you? Won't they hear?
Not if we're careful, Jake counseled.
He pulled a little plastic box free with his other hand and flipped it slowly across his fingers, grinning broadly behind her hand.
Venus squirmed a bit in her own seat, a smile working its way across her face too.
Sure, I'd love to.
Superb, Jake said eagerly, pocketing the box again. He stood up, squeezing her hand again, and switched the lights off in the main room, opening the door to his own.
Show me where to go, he said quietly.
One of the two glowing red eyes, now the only light in the room save the clock over the oven, narrowed a bit as Venus cocked an eyebrow, but she dutifully stood and walked up to the threshold of the bedroom, then backed slowly up until her legs hit the edge of the bed.
Jake walked up in front of her and slid his hands down her back to her waist, then lifted gently and pushed, easing her down onto the bedspread.
She clenched his jacket with both hands, pulling him down after her.
Jake pushed the door closed with his foot, kicking off his shoes as he did so.
He let his fingers slip back up to the small of her neck, running his thumbs across the line of her collarbone. She leaned upwards a little, her eyes narrowing yet further, but actually getting brighter as her blood started pumping a bit faster.
The key, he whispered, and the thing that every hiver learns more or less as a matter of course, is silence.
He tugged his own jacket off, dropping it into the darkness beside the bed.
So, he continued, let me know how you feel, quietly.
He unhooked his belt and slid his pants off to join the jacket on the floor.
Good idea, she said softly, her voice thickening a bit.
She undid her own clothes, dropping them down to his.
Like that?
Quick learner, he said, his voice barely louder than his breath itself.
He reached down to where his clothes had fallen, extracted the little box, pulled the condom out, and quickly applied it, the act illuminated by Venus' hungry stare.
Her eyes ran back up to his face, bathing it in hot red light, as he settled into his rhythm, and went out completely as she closed them.
He moved against her again and they flew wide open, but a finger to her lips kept her silent.
She wrapped both arms around his back, holding him close, and moved one hand up to the nape of his neck, gently guiding him in for a kiss.
Silence is golden, it turns out, she said almost inaudibly, shaky but jubilant.
Neither of them said a word for the rest of their quiet lovemaking, just enjoying the simple intimacy of the moment. When it was over, Venus lay curled up next to him as he cleaned up, the lights on now. They were just bright enough to get the job done. He pulled the towel he had laid out beforehand, just in case, out from under them, dropping it with the rest of the laundry. Venus looked over at him as he tugged the covers loose. "Should I sleep above the covers?" she asked faintly. Jake shook his head in confusion. "I'm kinda hot." Jake nodded, accepting the great truth she had imparted, and ran a fond hand up her flank. She giggled, slapping his hand away. "I mean my skin." Jake shook his head, pulling the covers back from the mattress with a smile. Venus looked at him for a moment, then wiggled under the covers. He slipped up against her back, planting a kiss on her neck. She made herself comfortable on the thin padding, lying on her side to save room. Distantly, she wondered what people did with single beds when they found a partner. Jake wrapped his arm around her middle, splaying his hand over her waist long enough to deliver a playful squeeze, before rolling over to lie back to back to her. From the sound of his breath, he was asleep in minutes. Venus lay there, dreamily content, and wondering about the logistics of their trip, until sleep took her too. Academic questions. Romilia stumbled out of bed the next morning, glad she had thought to set an alarm before falling asleep. Finding her clothes cleaned and neatly deposited by the bedside by a servitor in the night, she ignored them entirely for the favor of the set of much nicer formal uniform clothes in her bag. Finding them suitable, she laid them out on the bedspread before starting her bathroom protocols. Freya was busily devouring a stack of bacon and eggs in the kitchen when her cousin emerged, already in her nicer uniform. "Morning, Romilia," she mumbled through a mouthful of toast. "You ready for your thing?" "Well, it's an early one, so I'm a little nervous, but I'll be okay," she replied. "How about you?"
"I'm good."
"Wide awake. You always sleep this late?" "I was up at 0530 to go work out," Freya said. "No, I'm usually up much earlier, but I was really tired." They didn't need to discuss why, of course. "What's your workout routine, anyway?" Romilia asked, examining the obscene amount of food in front of her cousin. "MMPH," Freya said expressively, then forced herself to swallow before continuing. "Start with a 4-mile run around the lot, then a 170 rep hauler circuit. Usually do some free weights too, but I skipped that today." "Aha," Romilia said, eyeing the stack of food. Suddenly such a caloric intake seemed much more reasonable. "Where can I get some of that?" Freya jerked a thumb over her shoulder to the cooking servitor, and Romilia walked over to place her own order. By the time Freya's driver had announced that it was time to depart, both girls were ready, and climbed in. Freya noted that Romilia wasn't turning on her Vox. Romilia shook her head silently when Freya asked why, and her redheaded cousin decided not to press the issue. "So, when's your presentation?" Romilia asked. "Thursday morning," Freya said, "and it's Wednesday now, so I think I'm going to just chill here and work until I can call this paper finished," she grumbled. "Okay." The two of them clambered out of the car and walked in, Romilia nervously straightening her formal uniform. "How do I look?"
"You look fine. You'll handle it perfectly," Freya shushed, following her down the hall to the classroom they had chosen for the presentation.
"Now go, knock 'em dead." Romilia managed a little smile. "Thanks, Freya." She was reaching out to grab the door when a thought struck her. "Wait, wasn't Alex with you last night?"
"He had to go home early," Freya said regretfully.
"You just missed him. Practice for the semis."
"Ah, okay."
Romilia drew in a deep breath, let it out. "Okay. Wish me luck."
"Luck," Freya said happily, closing the door behind her cousin.
Omegan picked up her envelope and sighed under her breath, trying to dispel last-minute nerves. She knew what grade she had received, down the point. Alfaria had already gone, there was nobody else in the room but the proctor. So why was she nervous? Irritated, she brushed the nerves aside. She grabbed the envelope, pulling the paper inside out, and scanned the first few lines. A shiny, redder decorated the top of the page. Omegan relaxed. "Excellent. You did very well, Omegan, the proctor said. The visuals on your paper were very clever.
Thank you, Miss Cortle, Omegan said, sliding the paper back into the envelope and dropping it into the bag. I admit to some nerves beforehand.
You wouldn't be the only one, the art teacher noted. I was nervous when I did mine, too. And I picked a much broader topic than you.
What did you pick? Omegan asked, as she picked up her things to go.
I picked the negative effects of Hive Cube stratification on the economic future of Terra, the teacher said.
Cheerful, Omegan noted.
Well, I guess this is goodbye, isn't it? She asked, shifting awkwardly from foot to foot in the empty classroom.
It is. Have a nice summer, Omegan, the teacher said, waving slightly as her student moved to go.
You too, Mom, Omegan said as she closed the door. Alferia and Victoria were waiting in the lobby, under the watchful eye of a pair of beehives. A few well-wishers and sycophants were dispersing as she arrived. Clearly, they'd been there a while.
Alferia noted her sister's approach with a smirk.
See? Nothing to worry about.
How do you know how it went? Omegan asked.
I have my sources, Alferia said happily.
Yeah, and they're loud and annoying, Omegan grumbled.
How did you do, Vicky? I scraped the visuals.
But the speech went perfectly, and the paper was fine. So whatever, Victoria said, shrugging.
As per her usual tastes, she had somehow contrived for the buttons on her shirt themselves to be loose enough for the motion to set up some interesting echoes in her ample cleavage.
Eh? That's still good, Omegan said.
Yeah, the paper was really just an end cap. I'm done with this place, the platinum blonde said airily.
I'm looking out for the trip.
Trip?
Where are you going?
Alferia asked.
Victoria turned wide eyes on her cousin.
Whoa.
Really? I managed to get a piece of intelligence past the twins?
That's a first, she said.
Alferia sighed patiently.
You going on summer vacation?
No, I've decided to take Mom up on her offer, Victoria said, pushing the door to the outside.
I'm taking a year off. She wants me to start learning how to run the foundation.
Ha! I thought you decided to go to college and get that degree of yours first, Alferia said.
I did. Then, Morticia happened, Victoria said, climbing into the stretched limo in the parking lot.
Why did that change your mind?
Omegan asked.
Well, maybe I've just had enough of school for a while. But I also want the chance to spend some more time on my own, you know?
Learning how to run the foundation, Victoria hedged.
Omegan and Alferia didn't need to exchange a sly grin. They both knew the other had one.
That's your choice to make.
What does Uncle Fulgrim think?
Alferia asked.
He's happy with it, too.
But I think he would have been happy if I didn't wait, either.
The Echo lifted off, soaring into the heart of the noble district.
I'm not taking a year off.
Straight to college with me, Omegan said.
Already got accepted at Newbanks.
Political science.
Same for me, Alferia noted.
But I'm going to Cuthry, like Venus and Cora.
Really?
Victoria asked, looking back and forth between them.
Different schools for the first time?
Yeah.
It's about time, Omegan sighed dramatically.
Alferia couldn't help but grin. She'd have said the same thing.
What program, Alferia?
Education, for now.
Victoria leaned back, idly passing her envelope between her hands.
Since when are you even remotely interested in teaching?
I'm a multifaceted girl, Vicky, Alferia said mysteriously.
And I think I would do it really well. I was always good at finding out everything I need to know to talk to people for the first time.
Morticia knelt, lifting the little metal cube off of the floor, and stood straight up, shifting her weight through her knees as instructed.
Her therapist nodded.
Good. Any pain in the back?
No, it feels fine, Morticia said, experimentally working her shoulders.
No pain, no shortness of breath.
Then, my dear, in record time, I think you're ready, the therapist said, smiling indulgently.
Morticia beamed.
Fantastic. No offense, but I've had enough of this hospital to last a lifetime. So I would imagine, my lady, the therapist said.
And just in time for graduation, she added.
Yeah, I was really hoping that I would get out of it, the gray-eyed teen said dolefully. The therapist cocked her head. You wanted to miss graduation? I hate ceremonies, Morticia grumbled, swapping out a thin surgical shirt for a thicker black and green number she'd had sent from home. Grabbing the pile of clothes, she scooted behind the privacy screen while the therapist politely averted her eyes. I'd think that going to your graduation after you were told you couldn't would be something to look forward to, she said, turning her attention to the paperwork. Morticia snorted, pulling her own pants back on. For you, maybe. I'm going to be gawked at by reporters and various other bottom feeders for months, starting the second I set foot outside. I'll pass. I think it would make your family very happy to see you walk across a stage, the therapist said. When Morticia didn't answer, she backpedaled. Though of course it's your decision. Morticia sighed quietly as she finished dressing. I guess you're right. It's only a few hours long of a ceremony. I just wish people didn't attach such importance to it. Romilia walked out of the classroom in which she had made her presentation, checked to make sure nobody was looking, then let out a sigh of relief. She had aced it. She had nailed it. And now, she was done. Bar a few exams in the coming week, she was well and truly done at Imperator. She straightened up, a giddy squeal escaping her lips. Looking side to side, she didn't spot any of her usual cohort of friends and relatives, so she took off for the library, hoping to catch Freya. Freya herself was buried in a calculus textbook when Romilia nearly tackled her. Gurf, Jeduff, she managed through her cousin's headlock. She swatted the offending arms away, and stared up at her cousin. Well? I aced it. Romilia squealed happily, throwing her arms around Freya again. Yeah? Good job. Freya said, finally returning the hug. The student behind the counter looked over at her pointedly, tapped his lips. Freya took the hint and lowered her voice. Do you want to head out now, or stay and get ready for the test? Might as well stay, Romilia said regretfully. She sat down next to Freya and dislodged her textbook from her bag with an effort, opening up the review section. The presentation was tricky, but I think I got the point across. Good. How many judges? Only three, Romilia said. I thought there were supposed to be five. That's for the honor students only, Freya said. Roberta had five. Oh. The two girls sank into silence as they worked, passing notes back and forth as required, until Freya glanced at her watch. It's 1600. Want to head home? Yeah, I've had enough of this for one day, Romilia said irritably. Checking to make sure the student at the desk wasn't looking, she opened her Vox and checked. She looked over the tiny screen and sighed. Two messages. One from Mom, one from, also Mom, but using her office Vox. Are you going to call her? Freya asked, as they packed up their stuff. Romilia thought for a moment, her eyes downcast. I think I have to. Freya nodded in sympathy. If you want to wait. Romilia's grateful smile betrayed much weariness. Thanks, but I need to get this over with. Both girls trooped out of the building in silence, climbing into the car that had sat patiently in the lot for them. Once they were in, Romilia engaged the vehicle's soundproofing, and started to dial the number for her mother's office, and stopped. She fidgeted a bit, then hit the end button before the call could go out. I think I need to wait, Romilia said. Freya looked at her, her heart aching. Take your time. The car zipped over the Noble District, depositing the pair at the Russ Mansion. Romilia paused at the driveway, then looked down at the Vox. Freya, can you take this in? I want to do this out here, Romilia said, hefting her bag. Sure. I'll be in making a snack if you want something, Freya said, taking the bag, with one last worried look over her shoulder before she walked up the steps. A veiled insult. Romilia sat down on the stoop, flipping the Vox on and hitting the SID key. After one ring, her mother snatched up her own Vox. Romilia. My god, sweetie. What happened? She gasped into the speaker. I lost my shit, what else? Romilia growled. Suddenly the opportunity for a peaceful reconciliation was out of reach, it seemed.
I asked Dad why he never tried to help me get over my problem, if he had done it himself. He gave me some garbage about strength through adversity. Well, he never wanted you to know about his own history. He didn't want to scare you, I think. Romilia, she said hesitantly, before Romilia's curt reply cut her off. Bullshit, Mom. If he had overcome it himself, the very fucking least he could have done was help me do the same. Like a father. But no, he just had to threaten me with hospitalization and lecture me about weakness, Romilia snarled. Romilia's mother was quiet for a long moment. When she spoke again, her voice was tremulous. Romilia, sweetheart, I'm sorry he said that. Can you come home? I want to talk to you. We're talking now, Romilia pointed out. And you're not at home. I hear the fans in your office. I mean, the voice on the other end struggled for words. I want to talk to you. How did your presentation go? Aced it, I think, Romilia said, allowing a brief change of subject. Aside from the calculus test Monday, I'm done. That's really good to hear. I know you worked hard on it. Are you coming home for graduation? Mom, I'm sitting on the stoop of Freya's mansion. I can see our house from here, Romilia pointed out. Romilia, you essentially told your father that you were leaving indefinitely. I am well within my rights to be worried sick, her mother said, a little anger flaring in her voice. Romilia grimaced. Mom, damn it, I'm disappointed enough in this year as it is. Morticia gets fucking shot. I nearly come to blows with that. I've had enough of the house for a while. I'll be home before the road trip, I'm sure. Road trip? Lady Dawn's voice took on the tones of someone waiting for the other shoe to drop. What road trip? I've had enough of Terra for a while, Romilia said. I'm going on a vacation with Venus and Freya, and their boyfriends. Oh, well, that sounds fun. Where? Fenris first, then Nocturne, Romilia said, privately enjoying the little gasps of surprise her mother made at the names. 1 month of each, then home before school starts. That, Romilia. Sweetie, those are death worlds, her mother said, worry replacing anger again. You won't be safe. Out on the plains, maybe, but we'll be staying in the fortresses, Romilia said. It's decided. We're leaving in, let's see, 19 days. Well, all right. Is Morticia coming with you? Lady Dawn asked. She can if she wants to, but I suspect that she won't be up to it, Romilia said. She sensed her aggravation fading and tried to redirect the conversation. I'll ask her anyway. Lady Dawn squeezed the vox in her hand, trying to find something, anything, that could help to explain what her daughter was trying to do. She couldn't. Romilia, you know you can talk to me about things, right? When? Over our ever so cozy family dinners, which we hold so often? Perhaps when you're there when I'm crying in pain in the bathroom? Romilia shot back. I go weeks without seeing Dad. I go a week or two at a time without seeing you. When exactly can I talk to you about things? Romilia, that is not fair, her mother snapped. You're not the only person who ever needs my time. Romilia stared at her vox, overcome with disgust. Right. And the ability to prioritize them is one you have in abundance. I'm going to go thank Magnus for helping me. I'll call you some time. She hung up before her mother could say anything else, or before she could apologize for herself. A distant black speck appeared outside the hollow field, slowly growing larger as Romilia turned the vox off, fighting the instinct to throw it into orbit. The speck suddenly resolved into a vehicle, flying in over the treasury line to settle down in front of the house. Not wanting to inspire questions, Romilia pocketed the vox and walked up into the house to get ready to fly to Manga's. After freshening up a bit and changing out of her school clothes, maybe for the last time, she realized, she walked back into the great room to see a pair of custodes and a full squad of unarmored space wolves already assembled. They were deep in conversation with Freya about something, and didn't pause to address her, so she simply waited out of sight in the kitchen. Freya, after a few minutes in distinct discussion with her guests, wandered in, looking a bit harried. Ah, there you are, she said, yanking the fridge open and pulling a jug of water out. Sorry about that, the arrangements for the trip are stepping on people's toes.
I wouldn't want to trouble you, Remilia said.
Oh, hush, Freya scolded. It just means we'll be going on a salamander's ship instead of a space wolf's one. You ready to go to Magma's house?
Yeah, I am, Remilia said. She fidgeted for a moment.
Freya, what do I ask?
What's to ask?
Just thank him for helping you get your shit straightened out, Freya said, pausing to slug some water. But it didn't help at all.
Now my parents are reaching for my throat, Remilia complained.
But it's better than the alternative, Freya said.
And you said you would.
I guess I did, didn't I? Remilia grumbled.
Fine. Can I ride with you?
You can go alone, if you want, Freya said.
I'm gonna go hit the gym.
Oh. Remilia looked down to the floor, her courage faltering.
I should. She took a deep breath, steeling her courage.
All right.
Freya?
Freya paused, halfway out the door herself.
Yeah?
Remilia wrapped her arms around her cousin's waist.
Thanks for everything.
Freya grinned, squeezing Remilia's hands against her flanks.
Don't mention it. Don't get too mad, okay?
I promise, Remilia said sadly. She released her grip on Freya's midsection and walked out the door, looking for the limousine. The driver must have been notified from inside the house that she was coming, because he was waiting in the lot beside the house, already idling. Remilia climbed in and the car accelerated into the air, leaving Remilia to her troubled thoughts. What would she say to him? She gripped the armrest of the seat, her stomach rumbling in nerves. Her distraction lasted until the minute the car settled down. Steeling herself, she nodded to the driver as he opened the door and walked up to the imposing front door of the mansion. The slabs of metal, emblazoned with an Ouroboros design, had no visible seam, thanks to their careful design and placement. Before Remilia could knock on them, however, they swung open, betraying their deceptively low weight. Remilia took a step into the darkened antechamber when a hand reached out and grabbed her, pulling her into the house. Remilia stiffened, her hands gripping her assailant to throw them, but relaxed just in time. Her attacker had thick red hair and jasmine perfume, and was crying profusely.
Remilia, I'm so sorry, Miranda sobbed.
She clamped her arms around Remilia's shoulders and squeezed like a vice.
Please, please forgive me, we had no idea that would happen.
Miranda, it's okay, Remilia said, trying to soothe her cousin.
Really, I don't blame you.
Miranda pushed back from the blonde soccer player, her hands tightening on her shoulders even more. Her bandana was off, her eye was flaring with an unnerving light.
Yes, you do.
Don't hide it, she said, her voice dropping to a miserable whisper.
I deserve it. I thought Dad and I could help, but, Weedy drove you out of your own house, she wailed, burying her face in her hands.
Her knees wobbled, and she tipped against the wall, absolute humiliation dripping from her soul.
I'm so sorry, she managed, her breath shaking.
She clamped her hands over her mouth, squeezing all three eyes shut, looking unsteady.
Remilia stared at her, guilt twisting her own stomach.
Nerves, guilt, and exhaustion combined, until she felt a tear gather in her eye too.
Miranda, please don't cry, she said, letting her weariness show.
She sat the weeping girl down in a chair in the alcove, trying to let her resentment, or whatever Miranda was seeing inside her, fade.
Miranda's back heaved in grief and self-recrimination, as her despair overwhelmed her.
It never fails. I try to use my insight to help people, and I ruin it.
Stop that talk now, Remilia said, anger pushing her guilt aside.
I will not hear that again. If someone else's insight could bring things to a head with Dad like that, then it was inevitable.
Or worse, it would never happen, and things would just get worse.
So stop it.
Okay.
She leaned over to stare into Miranda's eyes. Tricky enough when she had three, harder yet when she was avoiding eye contact.
Stop crying, all right?
I promise I'm not angry at you.
Miranda sniffed, her sobs quieting.
What are you going to tell Dad?
What I'd like to know more is how you even found out, Remilia said, dodging the question.
It only happened last night. I was studying for my final test on Monday, and I felt something like a damn giving way, from your house.
Then I see a car heading for Freya's house, and it wasn't hard to figure out, Miranda said tightly, dabbing at her eyes with a handkerchief. That, and Rogel wasn't at work today until noon, and nearly beat the shit out of Dad when he got in, Romilia gasped. What? Dad tried to. They didn't fight, but only because there were two full platoons of custodes in between them, Miranda admitted, her hands twisting the kerchief. Or Rogel would have done it. If he was dumb enough to blame Uncle Magnus, fuck him, Romilia said coldly. Miranda looked up at her in wonder. You mean that? You really do? Like I said, Romilia said, her voice still frigid. All your father did was head the problem off. That does not excuse it, Magnus' resonant voice said from the hall. He walked up slowly from the stairs to his office, head hung in regret. Romilia, whether you think you need them or not, please accept my heartfelt apologies, and my desire to pay recompense. You did not deserve that. I would not have done it if I thought it would have ended so poorly. He turned his gaze to the side for a moment, as Miranda's own eyes narrowed suspiciously. No, he amended. I would have tried my best to heal the rifts in your soul, and hope that you would have been able to reconcile with your father, but I would not have called him to let him know you were coming. Why did you do that? Romilia asked. Because I was hoping that a brief discussion of his shortcomings would make your own inevitable confrontation more equitable. It has worked before, if you can believe that, Magnus said. I failed. Regardless, you are welcome to stay here until you feel comfortable at home once more. Well, I do appreciate it, but Freya's already put me up for as long as I need, Romilia said tiredly. Miranda offered her a tiny smile as the small amount of blame towards her and her father vanished from Romilia's heart. But, I have to know. Apprehension flared in her, striking a distinct tone in both Sika's vision. Am I, you know, healed? Magnus nodded. The trauma you have suffered may have scarred your mind, dear child, but your soul was tempered, not broken. You have nothing to fear. Well, that's a relief, Romilia allowed. She passed a fresh tissue to Miranda, before glancing at the door, where the limo was still visible, idling on the drive. Hey, what are you doing after graduation? In the short term, I want to go to work at the Scholastica Sicana office where Dad works, Miranda said, a touch of pride filling her voice. Magnus nodded serenely. I mean after graduation, as in, what are you doing this summer? Romilia asked. Oh. I'm going on vacation to Kashim, the resort world, Miranda said. Why do you ask? Romilia fidgeted a bit. I guess I just want to make sure we can all keep in touch after school ends. Miranda smiled ruefully. I know that feeling. I hear you're off on a road trip. Yeah, I'm going with Freya and Venus on their home tour, Romilia said, glad for the change of subject. Well, that should be fascinating, Miranda said. Can't say I've ever been to a death world before. Oh, and speaking of vacations, have you heard that Professor Ahriman has submitted a request for a sabbatical? Romilia shook her head. No. Is he going to write a book or something? He wishes to return home to Prospero, to contemplate, Magnus interjected. After what has transpired because of him, I do not blame him. Who's going to replace him? Romilia asked. Another former member of the Thousand Sons, Magnus said. And a former student of mine. He offered to use psychic healing on Morticia, Miranda supplied, but Mortarion and Morticia both refused outright. Romilia grimaced. Can't blame them. If she's going to heal on her own, anyway. Miranda nodded glumly. She flicked a lock of red out of her eyes, looking at her cousin askance. Well, I don't want to keep you. Uncle Magnus, Miranda, I mean it. I do appreciate what you did. This couldn't have done me any good just festering under the surface, Romilia said, standing up. Perhaps, dear girl, but I wish it could have been resolved better, Magnus said wearily. Romilia nodded, a grim smile on her face. So do I. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos.
Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.
All those moments lost in time.